Welcome to the Board of Selectmen meeting here on 6:45, Tuesday, October 4th. We opened up initially an executive session to discuss strategy with respect to litigation relations to the Hopkinton Wine and Spirits because an open meeting may have detrimental effect on the litigation position of the board. Also to discuss strategy in preparation for negotiation with all non-union personnel. The town manager, police chief, because an open meeting may also have detrimental effect on our negotiating position of the board. So as always, let's start with the Pledge of Allegiance. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic which stands one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty, justice for all. Excellent. Okay, now is a public forum where residents are invited to take a minute or two to share their ideas, opinions, or ask questions regarding town government. Is anybody up wanting, yes, please.
Did you say a minute?
Minute or two. I'm trying to run an efficient meeting. We got us out at 9:12 the last time. I don't want to waste anybody's time.
Tim Kilda, 45 Forest Lane. I've been involved in some way, shape, or form with the Boston Marathon since 1980. And as you know, we have an organization called 26.2 Foundation in Hopkinton that this board reviews every year. And you've stated it several times that you view the foundation as a community asset. And we have a presentation we'd like to make to the board tonight. But first of all, you ought to be congratulated about this room. This is a big change in here. You all deserve it, and so does the town, so nice job on the room. But several years ago, Buff Spencer, who some of you know lives in town, is a capable artist, painted a mural on the wall of the Elmer's Gym. And the mural is of the Boston Marathon course from Hopkinton to Boston. Several people saw that. This was about the time of the 100th Marathon, saw that mural and asked permission above to create a painting. And she did. The painting ended up being 6 feet long, and it depicts the course from Hopkinton to Boston. We've had one turned into a lithograph on canvas, and it's about time that we found a place in Hopkinton for this.
Where's your camera?
So the camera can see.
Camera's over there. The camera's there.
No. There you go.
And on behalf of the foundation, we'd like to present it to the board. We hope you find some suitable place to display it.
Great.
Awesome. Thank you.
Dorothy. Where's Dorothy? Dorothy, will you come up, chairman of the Hopkinton Marathon Committee? Will you be in this photo with us? Thank you very much. Appreciate it.
He'll give us some excitement and applause.
Mr. Chairman, I'd like to thank Mr. Kilduck, as well as the other members of the 26.2 Foundation, and all the people who put a lot of hard work and effort into helping to maintain our relationship and guide our relationship with the BAA. It's a shame that when we had that picture taken, we didn't have anybody whose run the marathon 25, 26 times with us. But that's a very generous gift, and thank you very much.
Thank you.
Same here. I've known Mr. Kilduff from when I was, I won't say little, but when I was younger, from right now, and he's always been synonymous with the BAA and the marathon, and he's done a great job year in, year out, long before there was any type of, financial stipends involved in it, and he's done a great job, and he's been a great ambassador for Hopkinton and for the marathon, so for that, I truly appreciate having you around.
That was the Hopkinton Athletic Association, wasn't it, back then? Yeah, it's great. Thank you very much. So,
I'm just going to say, it's really, the organization that's helped to bring the start of the marathon to the point where it is today. Making it somewhat of a destination, quite a destination, actually. It always amazes me. You see, tens of thousands of people here watching the beginning of the race. It's the only point in the race where you can see all of the runners come by within a short period of time. And really, you guys are largely responsible for helping to bring those people to our town, which really breathes a lot of life into the town. Yep. So, thank you.
Tim has done an awesome job for the town year after year. You're to be commended, as is your foundation. You work tirelessly to promote and advertise Hopkinton and keep us in the forefront. And this is a beautiful treasure for the town. And since we're doing redecorating, I might look nice right over there.
Yeah,
or over there. I think we'll have no trouble finding a suitable home for it. Thank you, Tim.
Thank you. So is there anybody else that has anything? Go on up.
Good evening, members of the board. I have a couple of pieces of paper. This is a bio. My name is Jerry Tewitt. I live on Price Street. My purpose, this will take about 3 minutes, if I may.
Sure. Okay.
My purpose for appearing here tonight is to request use of this room on October 26th or 27th, or someday close to that, for a talk by Dr. Charles Jacobs on radical Islamism in New England. Dr. Jacobs is a recognized expert on radical Islamism. He briefed the FBI and Homeland Security at their request. He chronicles the history, purpose, organization, people, goals, strategy, and tactics of radical Islamism in America. He talks about the violence, but more importantly, the force behind the violence. Everything he says is documented in court records, FBI records, and other public records. News reports of domestic terrorism appear with increasing frequency. We hear the term lone wolf. We hear the term conspiracy. Some of our leaders call it radical Islamism. Others call that term hate speech. Americans seem equally afraid and confused. But our leaders also seem to need better understanding of the underlying forces. I want to bring Dr. Jacobs to Hopkinton because the people of this community and our leaders need and deserve the expertise he has and the clarity he provides on the most serious threat to our freedom today. You will hear how entrenched radical Islamism is in America, how sophisticated and deceptive its tactics, its close connections to the radical Islamist forces in the Mideast and Africa. Dr. Jacobs traces the origin of radical Islamism in America to the arrival of the Muslim Brotherhood over 50 years ago. He describes the Council on American-Islamic Relations, CARE, and its ties to the Muslim Brotherhood and to known terrorists. Who of us is aware that CARE was named an unindicted co-conspirator in the biggest terrorist funding trial in American history? Who of us knows that CARE was blacklisted in 2009 by the FBI under Barack Obama? In our open society, CARE still operates freely throughout America. All of this is documented in government files. It is the tip of the iceberg that is radical Islamism in America. We Americans associate radical Islamism with the horrific violent acts. The bigger threat is the continuous infiltration of our institutions by the most dangerous and intolerant ideology of our time. Our best defense is knowledge and awareness. The most important function of our elected leaders is the physical security of their constituents and safeguarding our freedom. I offer to this community and its leaders the knowledge to deal with a sophisticated threat that only a recognized expert like Dr. Jacobs can provide. Please allow me to bring Dr. Jacobs to Hopkinton, to this room. The people of Hopkinton need to hear an expert and ask questions on the most serious threat to our freedom today.
Thank you. Thank you. So to book an event, you just have to see the town hall staff. You don't have to go through us for time and date.
Can I take that as permission to book an event?
No, you could. The town hall is a public venue, and members of the public are.
I did attempt to book a room. The town clerk said that I had to be sponsored by a committee or a board.
No, the. Public request. What we have here from town council is public town hall is a public venue where members of the public can request use for it for civic discussions. For example, it's been used in the past by civic organizations, political parties, marathon related entities. The board does not set a time or date for requests, and it's left to the professional staff. So, feel free.
May I just make a comment? I'm delighted to see the opportunity for a speaker of the caliber of Charles Jacobs, Americans for Peace and Tolerance, come to speak in Hopkinton. Unfortunately, this is the issue of our time. And I have heard Dr. Jacobs speak on a number of occasions. He is a recognized specialist on national security issues. Last year, the Washington, D.C. organization's Center for Security Policy held a full-day conference on the threat of terrorism, and Dr. Jacobs was among one of the many distinguished panelists that spoke in Washington, D.C. He is a renowned filmmaker. He's worked to produce a wonderful film. I went to its opening called Losing Our Sons that he produced in conjunction with the father of the young man who was assassinated outside the Little Rock, Arkansas recruiting station. And he toured the country not only with this young man's father, but with the father of the young man who was radicalized and did this terrible deed. He has a message to bring that is something we all need to hear. And when I knew that this was coming before the board, I did a little bit of background information and was reminded that unfortunately in the Northeast, we are not sheltered from this. The 9/11 hijackers flew out of Logan. We had a young man named Tariq Mahana out of Sudbury who plotted to bomb shopping malls such as the Natick Mall a few years back. Another young man graduated from Ashland High School. He's now serving a 17-year sentence for trying to fly airplanes into the Pentagon and the Capitol. He went to Ashland High right near. So we kid ourselves if we think we in the Northeast are immune from this, and this is a public information event with a noted speaker. I think it's wonderful if we can get a speaker of this caliber to speak in Hopkinton on the issue of our time.
Great.
Jerry, the only concern that you might want to think of is if this guy is going to bring, if he's going to come in and draw a crowd, that this room only holds so many. This may be, if it's a larger venue than what the census of the certain rooms can hold, it might not be the best place for you. It might be better to get a larger venue, but if your venue would stay within the allotted amount of people, then this might be a good spot for you. So all I'm thinking is that if you think you might have 300 people and this room holds 60 people, you'd hate to turn 240 away at the door.
Good. Yeah. Thanks for coming forward.
First, Jerry, I'd like to say that I support this 100%. I know that, I would think that the size of the expected crowd is also going to play into a decision on what venue is used. And depending on the venue and the timing and things of that nature, I just want to check to find out if the town is going to be incurring any extra cost. And also, depending on the size and the nature of the crowd, I want to make sure that we have the flexibility to provide any security from the police department, because I would imagine that given the right or wrong mix of people, it could, be something that strikes up some conversation, let's say. And I just want to make sure that everything, goes smoothly.
I'll take responsibility for any cost for extra security.
And what are you thinking of for a crowd?
I'll work with the chief. I think it's going to be fairly easy to limit it to about 40, I think, is what this room will comfortably hold.
Okay.
I'll work with some people, and I think we can do this in a way that only the people show up who are going to get in.
Okay. And how do people get in? Is it an invitation? Is it just showing up? Is it purchasing a ticket?
We haven't thought about that, but I think what we'll do is advertise it first come, first serve by reservation.
Mm-hmm. Okay. So there's no fee. Nobody's making money on this or anything like that.
Nobody makes money on this.
Okay. All right.
Nobody charges. Dr. Jacobs is quite anxious to be here.
Great. All right. Thanks.
Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Mr. Kamala, do you need any type of a motion? I know the town clerk was saying he thinks that there needs to be a sponsorship. Do we need to make any type of... No?
Okay. No, there's no need for a motion.
All right.
Excellent.
That's free, sir.
Great.
Hi, sir. Toasty. Sweet. So, sorry I'm late, folks. Just had something else I had set up prior that I had to. Yeah, that's cool. We've had that around for a little bit, yeah. That's nice. So, did Tim present that?
Yes, he did.
Okay. Mr. Vice Chair, just real quick. So we're out of one public forum. Did we wrap up?
Public forum. There were two people stepped up. I don't know if there's anybody else still up there.
Anybody else for public forum?
Did a nice job getting us 25 minutes behind schedule.
He's going to blame that on me for some reason, I'm sure. Okay, so with that, then we'll move to item 3. And thank you, Mr. Vice Chair, for holding down the fort. To the consent agenda. We have a parade permit. The Hopkinton Running Club would like to sponsor or hold a Memorial Road Race on Saturday, December 3rd. We have some minutes from 9:13 and 9:20. And we have a proclamation for St. John the Evangelist Church in celebration of its 150th anniversary. We have some board appointments and reappointments. As mentioned in the agenda, and then there's a one-day liquor license for Laura Berry and Katie Davenport of the Hopkinton Public Library. Does anybody want to break out any of the items in the consent agenda?
Three.
The proclamation for St. John's. Excellent. Thank you. Anything else? All good? Okay, so the chair will entertain a motion to approve the consent agenda as written in the agenda.
So moved.
Second.
Any discussion? All those in favor? Aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? It's unanimous and so carries. Mr. Catino, item number 3, the proclamation for the St. John the Evangelist Church.
Yeah, I just wanted to pull it out because it's, I don't want to just let 150 years of history go through a consent agenda. I just want to make sure that we give it its full net worth.
Thank you.
Do an actual presentation.
Yeah, I'll do that. I see that here. Thanks, everyone else signed. Father, how are you?
Good, thank you.
Welcome. Thank you for coming this evening. You want to join us at the table here and say hello to the community? 150 years.
You look so young.
I look pretty good at my age.
150 years.
Celebrating this event in the life of the parish. It's a celebration of the past, of those that have gone before us. And also, it's a nice tribute to our young people, you know, affirming what we've, you know, you don't know where you're going to go unless you know where you've been. And it's a nice affirmation also to our young people in the future of St. John's and the future of the town of Hopkinton. Thank you very much for this proclamation.
Well, that's great. We appreciate you coming tonight to celebrate this with us. I'm going to ask our vice chair to read this, if you would, please, so that all know what we've signed.
Who's on that? Town of Hopkinton. We, the Hopkinton Board of Selectmen, Town of Hopkinton, Massachusetts, are pleased to celebrate St. John's the Evangelist Church, 20 Church Street, Hopkinton, Massachusetts, on its 150th anniversary. The Board of Selectmen wish to congratulate the members of St. John's Evangelist Parish on this very special occasion. Signed under our hand this seal this fourth day of October, Brian Herrick, Chairman, John Catino, Vice Chairman, Todd Sestari, Claire B. Wright, and Brendan T. Ted Stone. Congratulations.
Thank you, Father. I can present this to you. Thank you for coming tonight. I'd like to sign it though, too. I didn't have a chance to sign it yet, so I'll sign that on there.
Get it to you.
Not at all. Not at all. We have the photo corner over here now. We call if you would like some of the parishioners to join us, that'd be great. Absolutely. Come on up. Anybody that wants to jump in. Sending this to my mother. All set? That's awesome.
Are they published? Can the publishers buy them?
Yeah, they're for sale.
That's a beautiful picture there, isn't it?
That is gorgeous.
Amazon or at the parish?
The parish. If people are interested, it's just to call the parish office. We'll be happy to get them out. It's like $20. That's great. Anyway, we'll get one over to the library.
Great. Thank you, Father. We'll put this up with some of the other items that we have. This look nice in the case. Nice job, Mary. Yeah, if you would, please, I'll get that to you.
All right.
Awesome. Thank you so much. Yeah, Claire. That's cool. This is right up your alley, huh? Okay, Claire, you got to pay attention. Give me that. Okay. Item number four on the agenda, we covered everything in the consent, right?
Yep.
Item number four on the agenda is the Boston Marathon Parade Permit. Doug Flannery with the BAA, I believe, is going to join us this evening. There he is. And how are you today?
Good, how are you doing?
Doing well, thank you. So this is the annual request for the Board of Selectmen to approve the parade permit for the 121st running of the Boston Marathon. Mr. Kamala.
Mr. Chair, if I may, Dorothy Federator Wallace, the chair of the Hopkinton Marathon Committee, is here with
us.
Is
she here?
And normally she joins the board.
Perhaps she would be so kind as to join us.
at our less stressful presentation table, instead of standing at the podium, you now get to chill and hang out, right? Is it better than the podium, you think, Dottie?
Yeah, I think it's quite nice.
Good.
What if we get you a cup of coffee? Yeah,
trying to be a little bit more welcoming here. Please, go ahead.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I guess we're kind of a young organization compared to the churches. We're only getting into our 121st Boston Marathon this year, so thank you for the opportunity to discuss the 121st Annual Boston Athletic Association Boston Marathon, and we'll hold in the charity training run that accompanies the event. My remarks somewhat brief, and you know, there's questions at the end.
Sure.
Our vision for 2017 is to work within the same roadway footprint as we did in 2016, thus not impacting any additional roads. The 26.2-mile route is a rolling course of 20 lanes, starting here in Hopkinton and finishing at the Boston Public Library in downtown Boston on Wellesley Street. For 2017, the event will take place on Patriots Day, Monday, April 17, 2017. The start times generally follow the same as they have for the last 2 years now. The military marathon march will start at 6 a.m. Those are Massachusetts Army National Guard soldiers. They will be marching without any kind of rucksacks or anything else on their other bodies. At 8:50, we'll have the mobility impaired. 9:17, we'll have the men's push rim military division. 2 minutes later, at 9:19, the women push rim division. 9:22 will be the hand cycle and duo participants. 9:32 we'll start the elite women. At 10 a.m. we'll start the elite men and wave one. And then every 25 minutes after 10 o'clock is the other successive waves. So we'll have wave two at 10:25, wave three at 10:50, and wave four at 11:15. We expect the last runner to cross the Boston Marathon start line approximately 11:28. The last runner to cross the Hopkinton-Ashland town line at around 11:55 a.m. And then expect the roads to reopen here in Hopkinton approximately around 1:30 in the afternoon. We are limiting the field size this year to 30,000 participants. So we'll have four waves of runners, about 7,500 runners for each wave. The time limit is 6 hours, and that's after the last person crosses the start line. So we'll shut the clocks down on Wilson Street after that 6 hour. We'll continue to use the Hopkinton school facilities and the fields for Athens Village, Center School for Athens with Disability programs, and we're also using some of the Hopkinton Arts Center for some of our meetings that lead up to the marathon and also for some of our charity runners. We're also talking with Crosspoint to use the CVS parking lot for some of our Cortegon facilities. We also have a PA announcement platform there. And the last chance for the runners to get some water prior to getting into the crowd system here in Hopkinton. As always, we appreciate all the support with DPW, the town of Hopkinton's police and fire departments, and all the auxiliary police that come in to support this wonderful event. Also want to note that the authorization should include the right to exclusively control and utilize the course roadway and adjacent sidewalks and other appropriate areas as determined in our planning sessions to conduct the race in a safe and controlled manner. Included should be the permission to erect necessary course signage, locate the official VA water stations, porta-johns, encourage timing mats, the mile markers, and other official functions. As in previous years, the fluid stations will be staffed by VA volunteers, and the first aid stations will be manned by the American Red Cross. Additionally, in support of the town of Hopkinton on behalf of the groups, the running clubs, the cheers, and participants and individuals that make their way to Hopkinton for their final long run, I respectfully request permission be granted to the BAA in its support of these groups from the hours of 6 a.m. to 11 a.m. on the morning of March 25th, 2017 for that last long training run. As in 2016, the private buses will be directed to a bus only drop-off location on Main Street. The runners not arriving by private bus will be directed to the center school. Regarding the road obstructing request, this is the same 2016 will be discussed with Lieutenant Porter and approved by Chief Lee. All the above are requested for safety purposes and will be under the guidance of the Chief of Police or his designee, 30 hours noted. In order for the Boston Athletic Association to conduct a safe and successful marathon and train run in Boston and the surrounding cities and towns on April 17th and March 25th, respectively, on behalf of the VA, I respectfully request that a parade permit be granted for next year's Boston Marathon.
Great. Thank you. Todd, are you all good with that? Is that?
Yes. I mean, we start our planning next month, November, and we work with the with Doug and all the STAR team captains, the race director, VA officials to make sure we can. And Hopkinton is actually with the purview of the townspeople, the selectmen, public safety, and everything. Everybody works very cohesively together and has for many years. And I think there's things along these meetings that will be discussed and then interchange if there's any additional like signage or things like that. The marathon committee and VA works that out. And I think.
Anybody? Any questions? Mrs. Ray.
I just have one question. This obviously is nothing new to us and to Hopkinton, but I did look on the permitting team comments and our fire chief, who is new in the position this year, and he questioned whether the clause about the exclusive control, that may be just standard pro forma language, but he was concerned that whatever arrangements be made be to the satisfaction of the town's fire department as well. So whether that was written in as a contingency or whether it was just, you know, we add a line that says subject to the approval or the participation of the Hopkinton Fire Department, something.
Well, I think our public safety in general, the police chief and fire chief, it may be standard language, but I'm not going to cede control of our streets and sidewalks to anybody outside of town. And to that point, I guess, I believe, Mr. Camallo, have you been able to get any type of meeting with the BAA and public safety? Are we trying to do something to that end?
Through the chair, at this point, we have requested a meeting with the BAA, Tom Grilk. We are waiting for a response from Mr. Grilk.
And when did the request go out?
It's been a couple of weeks now.
A couple of weeks.
I can check specifically. Let me check specifically.
Okay.
Yeah. Doug, are you aware of this meeting that we've asked for?
I am. I actually responded to Maria here yesterday, or even is today.
Yeah.
And I know she's out of office right now.
She's out. Yeah. Berlin, Mass, or Berlin?
But we did send a to talk about a date that we could all get together. And I know that MEMA has their first kickoff meeting for the marathon, November 2nd, where the executive steering committee gets together to start discussing all these security issues.
Yeah, I heard to Mr. Sestari's point, just, and then we'll keep coming around, but to follow on what he said, mentioning the sidewalk control. The sidewalk control has been a bit of a challenge for us in recent years, in that we've gotten a little bit more control, or the event has taken a little bit more control, and some of the businesses in the center of town have struggled a little bit with that. But does the marathon committee weigh in on that before a final barricade plan is put in place?
Little bit differently, but does still
And I don't question the motives, by the way, and I'm sure nothing different would happen this year than any other year, but bringing that verbiage to light, I hesitate to give anybody ammunition to say that, you know, we're giving up control of our own town streets to someone else. In the end, I want our police chief and our fire chiefs to have oversight on this and the final say.
It's just like the DPW also has oversight as far as a lot of issues with the roadways, with public safety and things like that. But everybody pretty much works together to kind of meet, you know.
And they do so incredibly well, you know, so. But like I say, just that verbiage, you know, when it's brought to light, it doesn't give me a great feeling.
I think the letter could, you know, be reworked possibly. Or come up with something this evening that could just be added that in working with the Marisol Committee and the public safety officials.
I'd say at that meeting, that would be a good time for the town manager and public safety just to go over that verbiage and, you know, make any tweaks necessary, and then we can vote on it at the next meeting.
Okay. So the town manager is distracted at the moment, but I want to get his attention on this. Mr. Kamala, Mr. Sestari was suggesting that when we get with Mr. Grilk and the BAA representatives for our meeting, to talk about a few different topics, that being one of them, that we work on some language that addresses the need for the controls of the sidewalks and roads, but also under the approval or something along those lines of town officials as well, inserting some language into that comment.
Yes, and in fact, one of my questions for Mr. Craig would be a clear definition of the rest areas. I'm wondering whether that also includes the common.
Yes, we probably need to sort that out. I don't think it's going to be a problem, but you know, every year we always sort of want to make sure we're all on the same page with these things. So I think Dottie needs to be at that meeting too, obviously. So it would be the town manager and your designees, myself, perhaps the vice chair, and then the marathon committee and the BAA representatives, right? That's what we're trying to organize now.
Yeah.
Does that work, Mr. Sestari?
Yep. Thanks.
Does it work? Mm-hmm. Okay. So we were going around a table here just in general about the application. But with that, Mr. Kamala, Mr. Sestari said we might want to hold off voting the parade permit tonight in anticipation of that meeting and that discussion. You okay with that?
Yes.
Are you guys okay with that?
Yes.
Does it cause you any issues not having the permit tonight?
No.
Yeah, I think you will get the permit. There's no rush, I don't think. Mr. Tesdo.
I don't have a whole lot to add to it. I've been around the town my whole life, and this thing has been going on for my whole life, and it's always been flawless. You guys have done a great job. The DPW, the fire police, everybody has done a great job. And I happen to, the year of the bombing, I happen to be sitting on that VIP section at the start, and I thought how fortunate we are that they went to Boston versus here, where for whatever my own reasons are, it's a great event, and like you said, it's, you can't go anywhere else on the race and see every single participant in the race in 45 minutes go by or an hour go by, and puts us on the map, and I'm appreciative that you continue to have it in Hopkinton. Thank you very much.
Mr. Catino.
Yeah, I'm good.
So in addition to the sidewalk control discussion and a couple of other things that we have on the agenda for our meeting with the BAA, sort of one-on-one, I was hoping that we could add and make sure we have on there some discussion about some of the support. The BAA has been incredibly supportive of Hopkinton over the years, and not only through the Marathon Committee, but with the Marathon Fund Committee for the additional funds that come in so many different ways. And one of the ways has also been, and I know this personally with my experience, is the numbers that we receive or the community organizations in the town receive to help us, you know, make Hopkinton what it is for all of our citizens.
And I think there's some discussion about maybe how that might shift or be adjusted a little bit, and we'd like to have a conversation about that as well. You know, there's great organizations in town that have grown to be very impactful organizations in town, not only in Hopkinton, but in Metro West and across the state. And if we were to sort of redirect some of the fundraising efforts that they've gone through in the past very successfully, I think that would challenge their viability going forward. So I'm hoping we can have that as part of our agenda. Mr. Kamalo, if you could add that there, please. I think that would be a beneficial conversation for us and the BAA so that we're all on the same page. Does that make sense to you?
Yes, and also in addition, Mr. Chair, since this event has become a very large event, we are consulting with our insurance company to see what this would mean for the community.
Okay.
Yes.
Yeah, good. All right, so we'll get all this done. We'll make sure that we're ready and we have it done in a timely fashion, but if we could kind of work with your team and our team to make sure we get together soon, that would be great.
Right.
Mr. Chair?
Yeah.
Just one point of clarification through you, Mr. Chair. I thought I heard, and I may be wrong, I thought I heard a couple of 6 a.m.s, a 6 a.m. military part on the day of the marathon and 6 a.m. for the March 25th. So was I correct in that?
You are correct. The 6 a.m. is the Massachusetts Army National Guard that the soldiers march down the course. And so they give an early start so they for their pace to finish up in mid-afternoon time.
I guess I'm asking, what time will those road closures be then? Because is this not a departure from the way it's usually done? I thought usually we had our road closures around.
The road closures will be around 7 o'clock in the morning. So the military marchers will start before the roads are actually closed.
Oh, so they...
Other than the bus stand and everything.
So the road won't be closed when they're marching.
Correct.
And how about for that training run, which was also a 6 a.m. on the 20th?
Roads are not closed.
Okay.
So, but we do provide support for the buses that come into town.
Right.
To do the drop-off.
But those aren't road closures.
They're not road closures.
Okay, yeah.
And the BAA's last few years have done an exceptional job with a lot of controls in addition to public safety.
Yeah.
The buses come out flawlessly right up to Hayden Park.
I'm so not a 6 a.m. person, so that caught my eye. Thank you.
Okay. So with that, we'll table it for a couple of weeks. We'll be in touch, and we'll get together soon, and then we'll work out the details and come back, and we'll get a vote of the board. Everybody good?
Good.
All right. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Mr. Kamalo, did we have a 7:10 continued public hearing for the Upper Trails Committee trail naming? Did we continue that a little further, or... I guess since it was already continued, we're not on the clock as much. Is that true?
Mr. Chief, if you're asking if we're ready to present this to the board for discussion, yes, we are.
So, but I'm just asking in terms of timing. Are we running late because we're not at 7:10? If it's a continued public hearing, is that a problem? I think if it's continued, it's continued till we take it up.
Exactly, till we take it, yeah.
And the town council's nodding. Appropriately, thank you. Okay, so we'll leave it there for now. All right, next up, item number 5 on the agenda, the Board of Selectmen will consider approving signage within the right-of-way on West Main Street relative to the Gateway Green project. Mr. Mezzett and Mr. Scott Richardson are here to bring us up to speed with what's going on out there and talk about some signage.
Yep.
Gentlemen, welcome.
History again. This was a privately funded beautification project in Hopkinton. The median strip is located 1400 foot median strip on West Main Street, and I think everybody's seen it now. Raise the funds, major donations, and what was promised was signage. The DOT did not want a signage system, which they wouldn't allow a signage system, which put commercial entities stack
Okay.
Kind of looks like you have two signs on the ends, which say Gateway Green.
Thanks, Scott. Peter, can you turn that the other way? So keep coming. Keep coming.
Camera.
Show it to that camera over there. There you go. And then bring it down a little bit. We just want to see it, the folks at home get a chance to see it.
Yeah.
And bring it my way a little bit.
That's good.
There you go. Perfect. Yeah. Don't move.
Peter, kind of like that.
Okay. So we see the sign there on the end. Sure.
So the sign on each end, which basically names the project. Adopted. This is, again, DOT language that we had to put on. Adopted by Hopkinton Chamber of Commerce. And then you can see the smaller signs that are going to be seven of them, about 150 feet apart.
Okay.
So we thought the style was in keeping with Hopkinton and the design view. I mean, it's not flashy, it's not Dunkin' Donuts in their colors. They all look the same.
Okay. Any questions? Mr. Stetson.
No. Peter, I think it looks great, and I think that these signs are very demure and not ostentatious. And if they were ostentatious, I still wouldn't have a problem with it, because what was there before were Dunkin' Donuts cups and empty nip bottles. So I think what you've done is a great job, and you should be commended publicly for taking an interest in making Hopkinton great again. And I think you've done a great job, and congratulations. Thank you.
And we are stronger together, too. Mr. Kamalo, do you have any thoughts on the signage?
I think, again, we commend the team for moving this project forward. As indicated in our report, staff recommends approval of the signs.
Okay, thank you. Mr.
Kamalo. Yeah, I have one. Elaine, if you could put your Zach head on, or your planning board head on for a second. From a couple years ago, because I got a letter from somebody been talking about a bylaw about advertising a business off premises. I just want to make sure we're not going into a gray area, and that because they look great, and it's and they're low key, and we have to make sure that we. Give credit where credit's due for the people that actually made this happen. You know, and especially, you know, and the way they're keeping it up. You know, I remember this summer looking and saying, oh my goodness, look at all the weeds there. And the next morning, boom, all gone. It was just fabulous. But.
So that was an issue that was discussed at the Design Review Board.
Okay.
And the original design did not have the word sponsor beneath the individual company. So at the, after the outcome of the discussion was that they would put sponsor on, so it's clear that it's not off-premises advertising, they're sponsors of this project. So the revised plan accommodates that concern.
Thank you. I just wanted to, because that'll come back up at Zach.
Small signs are, again, about 3.5 feet wide and about 2 feet high and about 4 feet off the ground. So the rubbish is fine. Okay, thank you, Scott. Claire?
Yeah, real quick. I mean, I'm going to come in and both sides of this issue. When I first saw the proposal, I saw 9 signs. I thought, oh my gosh, or I was concerned about sign clutter, over signage. But then when I looked carefully at it and saw where it spread out, we have to recognize that this is a beautiful contribution and asset to this area, and this has been all done gratis. These companies deserve
recognition for the wonderful contribution they've made to the town. I think that is deserved. The signs are spread out. I have a lot of respect for design views, that sitting on that board for many years, and take their recommendations to heart. I was a little concerned first about maybe the signs, the size of some of the signs, but also I was concerned that we're at the busy road, you don't want people slowing down to try to read a sign and then getting rear-ended or hitting. So I think there's a case to be made for the sign to be of a modest size, but a size and a simplicity that it can be read easily as they go by. And reducing that size further might make it hard to read and might encourage people to slow down in a place that they shouldn't be slowing down. So all told, having looked at the whole, and they are about almost 200 feet apart, I really think it's credit where credit is due, and these wonderful contributors deserve this recognition. However, I noticed in the recommendations of design review that they did recommend that this be renewed in 5 years. And I think that is worth looking at for a number of reasons. It can't be permanent advertising. We don't know how those signs will hold up. Some of those companies may have changed or not be here. Maybe someone else will have contributed to the maintenance instead. Or maybe their needs at a certain point, the advertising as it may be, needs to have an end date. There is a beautiful sign that's been installed on the landing right here at Town Hall that gives ongoing credit to this project. So I support the proposal. I would also support the 5-year either end date or renewal.
Great. Mr. Sestari.
Did you just have a comment, Scott?
Yeah, we want to respond to that because that is part of the program.
You can respond to the 5-year, but on the issue of the size, DOT considers that too.
Yeah.
Too small people will be. Yeah,
you know, and you slow down.
And they want, given the speed, to be able to read it. So
exactly.
That was all in depth of the DOT and approval to use.
Yeah, we had discussed that with the Design Review Board. We are open to, again, having that a condition of the approval that every 5 years we review the signage. Again, there's money in the budget to for ongoing maintenance of these signs. And again, if in fact a business does move out of town or is not here anymore and we replace it with another business, we would then reapply for a name change on that. So we're fine with that.
Okay.
Well, to that point, I think every 5 years the town should review whether this kind of signage advertising these businesses is appropriate. We may decide that it's time to just have the beginning and the end sign saying Gateway Green sponsored by, or and not have the, I mean, I think that whole thing should be reviewed, but that's.
So, ladies and gentlemen, we got a lot to do tonight. We got to keep focused here. Mr. Sestari, do you have any additional comments that would change?
Yeah, I do. You know, first of all, I want to apologize for being remiss over the summer. Every time I drive past that, which is at least a couple of times a day, I think to myself, this is great. You know, what an accomplishment. This is something that at our next meeting, I need to make sure I comment and, you know, give thanks to you folks who made this happen. Peter, I remember when you and Ken came, I guess, what was it, probably about 3.5 years ago, where you started talking about it. I remember Tim Kilduff was involved a bit too, and you know, saying, you know, this is something we can do, and we can, you know, do this without use of public funds. And of course, that always catches our ear, right? And it wasn't just there were a lot of different hurdles, ranging from it being, you know, state property to finding the funding. And you know, Scott, I know that you've been on on this train for a long time too, and helping out as you do in so many of the efforts in town. And I think it's entirely appropriate to give credit where credit's due. This wouldn't have happened if it was going to result or rely on public funds. And I think that the upgrade that it gives to that area, you can't even measure it. So I want to thank you. I entirely endorse this. I think it's appropriate. I think that not doing something like this is, you know, really, it's an error on our side if we were to say no. So thank you, and you know, I think that everything looks great, and as the years continue and things start to fill out even more, it's only going to be more beautiful.
Thank you.
So the chair will entertain a motion to approve the signage as submitted this evening for the Gateway Green project for a period of 5 years, at which time it will be then reviewed again by the Board of Selectmen and the Design Review Committee.
So moved.
Second.
Any further discussion? Mr. Kamal, are you good with that motion?
Yes.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? It's unanimous and so carried. It's all set, guys. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Have
Thanks.
A great night.
Thanks.
It's going to look awesome. It's going to look awesome. Okay, next up, and we are running a little behind here, so we're going to try and speed it up because there are some other time-consuming items coming up on our agenda tonight. We have the Upper Trails Committee trail naming. This is a continued public hearing. The Board of Selectmen will consider a request to name a trail off Granite Street to Echo Trail, quote unquote, and our town staff recommends this approval. Mr. Kamala, refresh my memory. Why is this a continued public hearing?
The Board of Selectmen approved a policy that requires the naming of any town asset to be approved by the Board of Selectmen in a public hearing.
But wouldn't we open a public hearing for each? I mean, well, how can it be continued? Is it going to continue for 100 years?
No, 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 no. What happened here was at the last Board of Selectmen meeting, the applicants were not ready to
I'm sorry.
Move forward.
Okay, that's what I was not clear about. Gotcha.
Yeah.
Okay. So are the applicants here this evening for the Upper Trails Committee, Upper Charles Trail Committee?
In fact, Elaine is the staff representative to the committee. And
so we are here this evening.
They were here. But
yeah.
Are you going to stay there or are you going to go over there?
I'll stay here.
Okay. Yeah. So Elaine, please walk us through.
So this parcel of land was purchased by the town in 2015, and the trail is concurrent with the old railroad bed that runs from Granite Street south toward Milford, and at the present time dead ends. And so they'd like to give it a name so that they can refer to it in their trail planning, and they've decided to call it the Echo Trail because of its adjacency to Echo Lake.
Echo Trail adjacent to Echo Lake. Gotta love logic. Okay. Let me just get my bearings here. So we're in a public hearing, and you're speaking on behalf of the proponent,
mm-hmm.
correct?
Yes.
And is anyone here, so we don't have another sort of other side, if you will, unless someone's opposed to it, but we can come to that in a minute. Okay, so we have that. So does anyone from the board have any comments specific to the naming of the trail? Before we go to the public,
I mean, it refers to Echo Lake, which is a long-standing historical geological feature. It's been Echo Lake since the 1800s, and so I think it's nice to name trails consistent with some historical feature of the land.
Okay, Mr. Starr, anything?
Wondering if we should have it be Echo Trail, 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 Trail.
Thank you, Mr. Sestari. Mr. Catino.
I'm fine. I'm on the. I'm
Mr.
On the
Tedstone.
Good. Nope. Looks good.
Okay. So we're in a public hearing, and what that means for those of you that aren't don't attend too often, this is an opportunity now before we close the public hearing and actually vote on the name to give the public an opportunity to come up and be heard. It's always interesting the public hearing concept, and we're going to do a couple of them tonight, or at least another one here in a little bit. Causes a little bit of confusion in town sometimes. So the Board of Selectmen operates in a open meeting, always, unless we go into executive session for specific purposes. Everything else is an open meeting. An open meeting is not a public hearing. An open meeting means you watch the meeting. It's all done in open, out in the open here, and you can hear what's going on. But by law, you don't necessarily get to be heard unless we call on you, which we typically will do in Hopkinton. We're very accommodating like that. But a public hearing requires by law that you get to be heard if you want to be heard. So now's your chance. If anybody has a strong opinion about the naming of Echo Trail near Echo Lake here in Hopkinton, please join us at the microphone. This is what always happens at the public hearing. Okay. All right. So with that, and I guess we would go to abutters first, but we would have abutters. Are there any abutters to the trail that are here this evening that would like to comment? Okay. Any members of the general public would like to comment? Okay. So.
I don't think anybody wants to come up.
So with that, the chair will entertain a motion to close the public hearing.
So moved.
Second.
Any discussion on the motion to close the hearing? All those in favor? Aye. Any opposed? With that, the board will now deliberate the naming of the trail. Does anybody want to make a motion to approve the naming of the trail off Granite Street to Echo Trail?
So moved.
Second.
We have a motion and a second by a motion by Mrs. Wright and a second by Mr. Catino. Any discussion on the motion? All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Any opposed? It's unanimous and so carries. So it is now Echo Trail. Great. Thank you. Okay, next up, Legacy Farms street name approval. The board will consider the approval of 12 street names in the North Club, Northeast and Northwest villages at Legacy Farms Development to be constructed off Legacy Farms North. Our town staff recommends the approval of all the requested street names as submitted. We have a new face, at least a new face to me for the moment, joining us at the Legacy Farm for Legacy Farms. Are you here on behalf of Legacy Farms?
I'm here on behalf of
Pulte Homes. Pulte Homes, okay, I got it now. All right, so Mr. Kamala, would that be a Pulte Homes application or would that be a Legacy Farms application?
It's a joint application, I think.
I'm sorry?
It's a joint application.
It's a joint application, yeah. So that's okay.
Yep.
All right, okay, everybody good? All right, yes, sir.
Mr. Chairman, for the record, my name is Mark Mester, and I'm here on behalf of Pulte Homes. We are the applicant of the recently approved site plan approval for a new residential village at Legacy Farms North, which would be accessed off of the newly constructed Legacy Farms Road North that runs from East Main to Wilson Street and out to Cedar Street. So, as I mentioned, we recently received planning board approval. There are 12 privately owned and maintained streets within the approved village, and we've submitted a request to the board for approval of the proposed street names. We did meet with public safety officials, I think it was last week or the week before, who made some comments, and we updated the street names in the map that was submitted to the board on September 21st. Which is before you. I have copies if you don't have that, but that's what we're here for.
So all public safety personnel that weigh in are good? Okay, would you mind reading the names, please?
I'd be happy to. So there's a map that has Road A through Road N. So Road A would be Walnut Way. Road B is proposed Locust Lane. Road C and G, it would be Spruce Street. Road D would be Redwood Path. Road E would be Juniper Trail. Road F would be Primrose Circle. Road H would be Eagle Trail. Road I, Hawk's Nest Path. Road J and L would be Magnolia Drive. Road K, Cherry Lane. Road M, Holly Trail. And Road N would be Cottonwood Court.
Great, thank you. Mr. Kamala, any other comments on the request?
No additional comments from staff.
Mr. Sestari.
Just wondering if there's a difference in topography that H and I are Eagle Trail and Hawk's Nest Path, and everything else seems to be after a tree. Just wondering.
No, there's no topography differences in those
just roads. A random thing.
Just a marketing names that our marketing folks came up with.
All those houses are up on trees.
Mrs. Wright.
My only comment is the editor in me thinks Hawk's Nest should have an apostrophe. It would seem to be possessive. That will bug me continually.
Mr. Catino.
I'm fine with her addendum.
Good.
Good? Okay. So Hawk's Nest, possessive, we going with that?
It's the nest of the hawk. It's the hawk's nest.
Do we do apostrophes in street names?
I don't think so. Not typically, but.
Looks kind of weird.
Maybe it just means it's plural. More than one hawk.
I'm just thinking in terms of public safety databases and things like that. If we start throwing funky punctuation in, it might accept it or may not accept it. And
incorrect. Let me just ask you, to Mr. Sestari's, you've got all the botanical names, which are a recognition of the Western nurseries. Why did we do the two birds? Why didn't we stick with, can we come up with a couple more botanical names and make it consistent?
We could. I mean, I think the answer is we were getting pretty far down on the tree list as we were going through.
But I think we've also kind of been through the process internally to get all this approved.
Willow Way.
How about if we put a motion forward that looks into the possibility of throwing an apostrophe in there?
Or a botanical name. I mean, just be consistent.
But if we change the, if we go to a botanical name, we're changing the name, then we're kind of keeping the whole thing open.
We also, I don't think we have the right to tell them how to name their streets.
You can approve everything else.
I'm sorry?
Just have those two be open.
No, I understand that we have the right to, but we can't make them stick with a theme. We can, I mean, they can have, as long as the street names don't rhyme with other streets, then, or sound like other streets, or.
I really would encourage the board not to get into the weeds on every issue that comes before us. Pardon the pun, yeah, let's not go the weeds way. Let's just try and stay out of the weeds. We are here to sort of oversee the policy. They brought a bunch of names forward to us. They've got some marketing people. They pay a lot of money to come up with these things. We've spent money with town staff time going through it. I just think it's one of these things that we probably should just say okay and move on. But if someone feels very strongly, then make a motion otherwise.
Incorrect English.
I don't feel strongly about it, but I will just remind the chair, I know of a couple times in the last, you know, 7-8 years that I've been on the board where members of the board have suggested removal of all the possible names to come up with a name that was more fitting with the particular area due to historical significance. Mm-hmm. That said, I don't think that, I guess the trees, the botanical names do have a historical significance due to Western nurseries.
Yep.
But, you know, again, this isn't something that I'm going to jump up and down about.
The chair will entertain a motion to approve all the street names as mentioned, except the two relative to the birds, and encourage the applicant to come back with two additional names for those two streets.
So moved.
So what we have is a motion on the table to approve 10 of your 12 names, all the ones except Hawk's Nest and Eagles, whatever. And if you could do a little bit more work on those two, run back through the town manager's office, we'll get those done at our next meeting.
That's fine, Mr. Chairman.
Okay.
We've worked with Ms. Wright for quite many years on this project, so I respect that. We can adjust.
So we have a motion on the table for the 10 of the 12 names. Any further discussion? All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Any opposed? It's unanimous and so carries. Thank you, and we'll get the other two done for you real soon. Okay, next up, tree removal, item number 8. We've been asked to consider the approval or the removal of two trees at 15 North Mill Street, which has been requested by the property owner. This matter is before the Board of Selectmen because two letters of objection were submitted to the tree warden at his public hearing. The tree warden recommends approval. The planning board has issued a scenic road permit. And then the second item is a tree removal behind the public library at 13 Main Street. The Board of Selectmen will consider removing or approving the removal of a twin hemlock tree behind the library based on recommendations from the Permanent Building Committee and the tree warden, Mr. Paul Gleason. The tree warden states that the tree is dying of hemlock woolly adelgid and recommends approval. So let's try and take the second one first, if we could. So we have a tree at 13 Main Street behind the library that is dying, and the tree warden has recommended that we take that down. I'm assuming there's a safety concern as part of that recommendation. Hi, how you doing? The tree at 13 Main Street, is there a concern about safety with respect to that tree?
Yes, ultimately.
I'm sorry?
Ultimately, yes.
Okay.
It's not an immediate hazard, but it's dying of hemlock
already on its way out. It's only got maybe 2 or 3 years to live.
Okay. And Dave, you're here because of the library project that's going on right with it. So what's the view of the permanent building committee based on what's going on with the library?
They had authorized me to ask Paul to make a determination because they'd like to see if the tree could be removed.
Okay.
It's in the way of some proposed drainage, underground drainage pipe that's going to wrap around the back end of the library. And the tree and the roots are, they make actually growing into the foundation of the library. So,
do we know how old the tree is?
Probably say about 75, 80.
75 or 80 years old, okay.
Educated, yes.
Mr. Kamalo, any thoughts on the situation with the tree by the library?
I have no further comments beyond what Mr. Gleason and Dave have shared with the board.
Okay. Mr. Catino.
I'm fine with it.
Mr. Tedstone.
I'm good.
Mrs. Wright.
Oh, I understand the need to take down, and we've had a tree that had that situation, so I completely understand. I'm just wondering, is it in a location that it, in its better days, provided any screening, any landscaping, any shade that we should look to replace it with something else that will, you know, contribute to the neighbor's privacy?
Yeah, I contacted Mr. Buckley, who I think is one of the trustees from the manor house, because it's almost in the backyard of that. As for shade, and he said it was based on the tree warden's determination, they were okay with it coming down. I know a permanent building committee had sent out an email to other abutters that the tree was possibly going to have to come down. I don't think they received any feedback. As from shade, I think the shade would come out.
It would be, well, you would have shade in the morning from this, the tree as it exists now, except the damage done by the Adele did is to destroy the needles. So you're really, at this point, you're probably about 50% of what you would have had at the top end of its health.
Yes, well, and through you, Mr. Chair, I'm not arguing with the need to take the tree down. My question is, when we were looking at the whole plan for that library, there were issues with the neighbors and screening. Did this tree, in its better days, provide an amount of screening that is important to those neighbors that something should be replaced to replace that screen?
In its better days, I would say yes. But we're talking 25, 30 years ago.
Right. I understand that. But I'm just saying, should we, as part of this being taken down, should be this be part of the library plan for a planting to go in there to provide screening that they're now losing? I'm not saying the tree shouldn't come down.
Dave, do we have a budget for any kind of replacement of screening or trees of that nature?
I think we would. I'm just not sure. The amount of town property, we would have to plant it on private property. The amount of town property on that side of the lot, we might have 2 feet.
And you spoke with the...
What's going to go where the tree is?
Put it in the hall.
You know, it's, the tree's so close. I wouldn't recommend planting another tree in that spot. It's a foot, 2 feet off of the existing building.
Okay.
As for screenings, I don't think, you know, the first branch is 30 feet up in the air, so I'm not sure it provides any screening, visual screening right now. There might be some minimal shading.
And you did speak to the property owner that's affected by this, correct?
For the manor house, correct.
Okay. Mr. Sestari.
Yeah, I guess my only comments were going to be along the same line as Ms. Wright's, in trying to protect the neighbors and put any type of screening there that we could, but I didn't realize that it was so close to the building. I wanted to make sure that we don't remove this and then have that space become parking lot. But it doesn't sound like that's the case anyway. So.
Yeah.
Okay.
And the primary reason for the recommendation is because of the sickness and not because of the difficulty of construction around it or the fact the roots are going.
Primarily the insect infestation.
Okay, thank you.
Good.
That's fine. Thank you.
Okay, Mr. Richardson, you raise your hand.
Chair, I just want to clarify. I believe this tree is behind the commercial building and is not behind any of the residential property. Is that correct, Dave?
Behind, it's between the manor house and the library.
Right. So it's behind a building that's commercial, not residential. Not used for
Thank you. Okay. So,
the chair will entertain a motion to approve the removal of a twin hemlock tree from behind the library based on the recommendations of the tree warden.
So moved.
Second.
Any further discussion? All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Aye. Any opposed? It's unanimous and so carries. Okay, item number one on the tree removal discussion. There are two trees that a property owner is requesting to remove at 15 North Mill Street. This matters before us because two letters of rejection objection were written to this tree warden at his public hearing. The tree warden is here, and ma'am, you are? And you own the, you're the property owner. Okay, great, excellent. So why don't you folks walk us through what you're trying to do and why, and then we'll take it from there.
For a few issues. Number one, backing in and out of the driveway is dangerous because of particular large oak that's on the corner, which is part of the plan. And the existing width of the driveway is prohibiting trucks from accessing it when we have deliveries. Because of the width of the driveway and the placement of the tree, trucks can't get in and out, so they're forced to actually park on North Mill Street to make deliveries, which is blocking traffic. Backing out is particularly difficult because as you back out, you don't have a wide turning radius, and North Mill is already very narrow at that point. So you run the risk of not only hitting the tree, but the stone wall on the opposite side of the street. So we're looking to widen the driveway to approximately 50 feet, according to the plan submitted. We'll pave the driveway, which is currently gravel. The existing oak is a concern because the roots are very close to the side of what will be the driveway, so we're concerned about the pavement being damaged. And we'll widen it from both sides. So there's a cedar tree on the opposite side of the driveway that is on town property, so that cedar tree would need to be removed as well. We did have a hearing with the planning board. All were in favor but one. Received approval with conditions. We're here because we had two letters of objection from residents who live on the other side of town. Just a couple points I want to bring up. The fire chief was actually at the hearing with the planning board and confirmed the risk. He stated that, quote unquote, he probably can't access the driveway with fire apparatus because he can't make the swing. He went on to say, for public safety, if somebody is willing to open the driveway some, it would help access the driveway. During the meeting, the chairman also advised he drove by the property a number of times to get a good idea of the situation. He raised concern, saying that it would also be difficult to get in and out. The tree warden, I guess, had passed by and didn't have an issue, didn't attend the meeting because he knew we would ultimately end up here. Again, there were some conditions that we have to comply with. And some of the things that came up in the meeting is that if this was new construction, we would need to meet the new requirement of 20 feet. And the it came up in the meeting that there was a concern about how much pavement there would be, and it was confirmed that the planning board couldn't regulate the amount of pavement, so it wasn't so much the width of the driveway, but the trees in question. I did have a plan. Do you want a copy of the plan, or do you have one there?
So we get electronic versions of stuff.
Okay.
So.
All right. And I also took some photographs. This gives you a sense of, gives you a sense of the trees that are circled in red that need to come down. You can see visually the width of the driveway and damage that's already on the oak tree.
Great. Anything else?
No.
And you concur that the trees should come down?
I do. The tree has been damaged multiple times over the years, probably as the lady describes, different vehicles passing in and out and hitting it. There is no root system on the driveway side. I think you have a photo that I sent in of it. There is no root system there. So there is obviously a loss of stability at that point. given the damage done by the gypsy moth this year and the subsequent drought, the condition of the tree is only going to get worse as time goes on. So as far as I'm concerned, they want to remove it, it's fine with me, because 3 or 4 years down the road, it'd be removed by my budget, and I just assume that one.
Okay, nothing wrong with looking at the budget, too. Okay, and Ms. Lazarus, can you just describe, it says here, the planning board has issued a scenic road permit. I think I understand, but let's share what that means.
So the planning board, under the scenic road bylaw, reviews and issues permits for removal of trees within the road right-of-way. So the board reviewed this application, you know, heard the testimony that she discussed, and voted to authorize the removal subject to approval under the shade tree law, which is why she is here tonight.
Okay. All right. Mr. Tedstone.
Well, the only question I had was, I didn't know why you would go on a driveway from 15 to 50 feet, and if you could lessen it a little bit, maybe we could work on not taking the trees down, but after hearing
feet.
From the...
There's only 20 feet she's going to win. You've gone 20 feet wide.
You're just expanding it 5 feet?
Yeah.
Never mind. I'm good.
Fair enough. Mr. Catino.
Yeah, and I was at that planning board meeting, and when I heard, as soon as I heard Chief Slayman say if it was new construction, it would require a 20-foot driveway, and the trucks could not make that turn. And so just for safety's sake... And if they're paying for it, I'm good with it.
Okay. Mr. Sestori.
I'm a strong advocate of property owners'
rights. And, you know, short of finding out that these trees are home to, you know, snowy owls or spotted turtles or something like that.
Hawk's nest.
Yeah, a hawk's nest, exactly. You know, I'd have a difficult time saying no to this. Pavement. Pave your front lawn if you want. I don't care. You know, it's your property.
Okay. Mrs. Wright.
Well, I am a strong supporter of our scenic roads bylaw, and the reason we have it is because people would be cutting down trees right and left for their convenience, and then we wouldn't have a scenic road anymore. The street that kind of goes with the territory, the trees and the stone walls are what give the scenic roads its scenic character. However, in my years on the planning board, we took the advice of the tree warden very seriously. And in the case of these two trees, it appears that you know, they are not healthy trees, and they will probably be taking themselves down or need to be taken down in short order. So you know, very often we saying planning board approve these kind of requests with regret, but understanding the necessity. I'm always sorry to see a tree go. I did read in the planning board decision that there is a requirement for replanting. Can you just tell us where those trees will be? Are they going to be replanted in some significant area that, even though it's on private property, it contributes to the scenic character and the shade cover of that area?
Yeah, with the expansion of the driveway, what we'll plan to do, and obviously we need approval on the types of trees, we hope to do a maple tree on either side of the driveway to provide the shade and also, you know, bring some color and life to that part of the yard, because right now it's just full of pine trees.
Mm-hmm.
Well, any thoughts on this tree or these two trees?
I'm good at this point.
Mr. Chairman?
Hang on one sec, please. We're gonna come around to that. I don't have any strong opinions other than I support property rights, but I do love the scenic bylaws that we have and roads we have here in town. So this is why we do this. So we look at safety and we look at the scenic roads and we sort it out. So it makes sense to go through the process a little bit. Cumbersome, but it is what it is. With that, I do want to see if there's anybody that has anything they'd like to say from the public about it. I know that that's what sort of spurred it coming to the Board of Selectmen instead of staying with the tree warden. I would ask that the comments be kept to 2 minutes, and that they not become anything more than factual information specific to their concerns. Mr. Harrell.
Thank you. The citizens of the town of Hopkinton years ago put on the town bylaws, the scenic road bylaws, because the people that wanted to protect it, this town looked like. The people of North Mill Street put a petition, put an article on the town warrant because they wanted to protect North Mill Street. And the other comment I wish to make with respect to property rights, these trees are not on the petitioner's property, they are on town property. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Harrell. Anybody else? Seeing no others. Okay. So we have a request before us to remove these two trees or allow the removal of these two trees. Does anybody want to make a motion to remove the two trees at 15 North Mill Street as requested by the property owner and
so
approved
moved.
By the tree
Second.
Warden? This is Mr. Sestari and Mr. Catino. Any further discussion? All those in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? It's unanimous and so carries. Thank you. Thank you, Paul. Have a good night. Okay, moving right along. And my apologies if I feel like I'm rushing us. I'm just trying to help us get through the evening. So next up, and it was scheduled for 7:45, but because it's not a required public hearing, we didn't go and open it and then continue it and sort of do the typical public hearing stuff. We're going to hold a public hearing, which means we're going to give everybody an opportunity to speak specific to the Hopkinton Center for the Arts and their request or their lease agreement modification that we've been working through for the last couple of weeks, if not months, here in town. So let me just describe what I see the process to be for the next half hour or so and make sure that we're all on the same page about what we're trying to do. The Hopkinton Center for the Arts is not applying for a liquor license. If they were applying for a liquor license, we would be having a public hearing, but they are not applying for a liquor license. We're working through a lease agreement amendment that will allow caterers to come on and do certain things. We can talk about all that. But we're having this discussion tonight in a public hearing so that everybody gets a chance to voice their concerns, yay or nay, specific to the request by the HCA. What typically happens is we'll have the applicant make some comments specific to what they're trying to do and why, and then we'll have some other discussion perhaps with another entity. This time it'll be town council and perhaps our town manager. The Board of Selectmen will have some comments, maybe ask a couple of questions, and then we'll go to abutters first, and we'll go to the general population or general public after that. Of the town of Hopkinton and anybody else that wants to comment for that matter. We ask when we get to the public comment portion that the comments be kept to 2 or 3 minutes, that they stay focused on the facts as you understand them and you present them in a way that everybody will listen and not be horrified or offended. So please, let's try and keep it all nice and calm. But that's sort of how I see this unfolding over the next 30 minutes. Do my colleagues all agree with that approach?
Yes.
Mr. Kamalo, Mr. Mieres, you good with that approach? I'm sorry?
You might want me to go first.
I want you to go first?
You might want
you
me.
Might. I might want you to go first. You're right, so maybe we'll do that. We can do that, and then we'll let the HCA comment. And then we'll come to the public, and it's 2 to 3 minutes for comments. Once we get to the point where we're just kind of repeating ourselves, but it's a different person saying the same thing somebody else said, we may cut it off, okay? So because we're going to get a pretty good feel, I think, fairly quickly what's going on. And then we'll try and wrap it up. Perhaps we'll take a look at, and we'll close the public hearing, if you will, and then we'll see if the board can deliberate and try to come to some conclusion tonight. So I just want to ask everybody in attendance who's here for this issue, does everybody agree with the process that I've just outlined? Does anybody have any issues with the process I just outlined? So I do this all the time for public hearings, because if you step outside the process we just outlined, you're stepping outside of your own agreement. And then I can say you have to stop. Okay, so everybody's good with what we're talking about, right? Excellent. Okay, so with that, the chair will entertain a motion to open the public hearing to discuss the Hopkinton Center for the Arts lease amendment or lease agreement amendment.
So moved.
We have a motion to open the public hearing and a second from
second.
Mr. Tedstone. Okay, so any discussion on the motion? All those in favor? Aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Okay, so the public hearing is now open, and we will turn the microphone over to Mr. Ray Mayeres, Town Council for the Town of Hopkinton. Mr. Mayeres.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. The reason I thought I'd go first is because I think I can outline what some of the issues are, and maybe this will make the matters go a little more organized. So, as you indicated, the town has a lease with the Hopkinton Center for the Arts that was executed in February of 2012, and it was issued based on an RFP from 2011, responses that were submitted in July 2011. I had an opportunity today to look at those responses again, just to refresh my memory, and it's clear from the responses to the RFP that HCA intended to get a large part of the revenue from this project from rentals. Nevertheless, there are two provisions in the lease, Section 6B, which says that HCA can use the lease premises only for a purpose that enriches the lives of Hopkinton residents and others by offering community programming and activities that serve primarily a diverse range of residents and others. And Section 6I, which says that HCA may not assign the lease or to make any sublease of the lease premises or any portion thereof, except to entities with uses that are permitted under the terms of this lease and uses that are consistent with and complement the tenant's use without the express written permission of the landlord. That's you, the town. Okay, so last February, you may recall that HCA applied for a Section 12 liquor license. That's a pouring license. And thereby focused the board's attention for the first time on the fact that HCA intended to rent out its facilities for private functions unrelated to its community programming and to serve alcohol at those functions and possibly at other functions. So we're talking about things like weddings and celebrations and business functions that are otherwise not part of their regular programming. The only connection to the HCA's community program is that they generate revenue to support the continuing operation of the center. So in the course of that hearing, it became obvious that a Section 12 license was a poor vehicle for authorizing alcohol service at the HCA, since the ABCC rules do not allow you to restrict service hours nearly to the degree that the board wanted to, and even though HCA was willing to accept such restrictions, you don't have the authority to impose them. So there are two other licensing approaches that seem better suited for this sort of facility. One is under Section 14 of the liquor laws, an applicant can obtain a one-day, so-called one-day liquor license, which despite its name usually needs to be for more than one day. And the alternative is that under Section 12C, catering companies can be licensed directly by the ABCC. That is, you don't issue the license at all. And it's my understanding that HCA intends to move forward using licensed caterers when possible, and otherwise will be applying for one-day licenses for their events. Either way, the events will need to comply in all respects with applicable ABCC regulations. But there remains the issue of whether the proposed events, regardless of whether alcohol is served, can be undertaken under the lease without first getting the town's permission. And on this point, HCA's lawyers and I disagree. So rather than having this matter settled in court, which seems like a rather expensive way to deal with all this, Norman and I agreed to sit down with HCA's representatives to see if we could come up with some middle ground. The result of that effort was the original lease addendum that was presented to you 2 weeks ago. That document did not receive universal thanks and praise, however. So Norman worked with individual selectmen to come up with a number of changes that could address specific concerns that were raised. So the new addendum that was in your board package has a few new provisions. One is that it limits the total number of independent rental events to 30 per year instead of 36, of which no more than 10 may be larger than 100 people. That's down from 12, and none may be larger than 150 people. Also, not more than 10 of the events and not more than 6 of the larger events may be weddings. In addition, the number of independent rental events is limited to 1 per day and 4 per month. It requires independent rental events to end by 9 p.m. Sunday through Thursday and 11 p.m. on Fridays and Saturdays. It requires 2 weeks' notice of the events to the town manager, the police, and the fire chief, and it specifies the contents of those notices. It's not just, hey, we're going to have an agreement, an event. It's specifies specific things that are, need to be in the notice. And then it requires the town manager to approve the events before they happen. It limits alcohol service to beer and wine only and prohibits outdoor consumption of alcohol. It also makes HCA, in addition to the caterer or the licensee, responsible for certain aspects of ABCC compliance. Notably, it requires them to carry their own liquor liability insurance. And giving the, it gives the Board of Selectmen the right to terminate the addendum if it's unhappy with how things are working out. I should note that the HCA has not agreed to these changes and indeed has objected to several of them. So specifically, HCA wants the maximum size event to be 250 people rather than 150. They want the independent rental events to be allowed to end at 10 Sunday through Thursday rather than 9 and 11:30 on Fridays and Saturdays instead of 11. They also object to the requirement of town manager approval. They object to the limiting of service to beer and wine. And they want to have outdoor service whenever the high school and the middle school are not in session and no school-sponsored event is taking place on campus. They object to carrying liability insurance, and they want to limit the grounds upon which the selectmen can terminate the addendum. So the currently the grounds are rather broad. They would like to limit them. So. Rather than attempt to resolve all of those differences and then bring you back something that was may or may not meet with your approval, we decided to get the collective wisdom of the community and of this board before we proceed to try to resolve these differences. So that's where we stand, and that's why we're here.
Okay. Thank you very much. Mr. Kamala, anything to add?
Nothing to add at this point.
Elaine? All good. Kurt, you want to join us? Kelly?
So thank you for working with us. Kurt Flagoff, I'm co-chair of the Hopkinton Center for the Arts. I live at 76 West Elm Street here in Hopkinton. And just on the points that you're raising, some of those have evolved up with what we're proposing currently. But I'd like to start off just sort of taking a look back and recognizing the fact that the reason that there's an art center out there at the town is because of the vision and leadership of the town elders, of the town government. Back in 1996, 20 years ago, the town decided that they were going to vote and purchase the Terry property, the farmland for the schools. And having the foresight, the town set aside 1.3 acres for cultural purposes. At that time, there was a group of five artists. They called themselves the Cultural Arts Alliance. And they had been meeting in each other's houses for 5 years. And they came to the town. They said to the town, you know what? Let us run an art center out of the farmhouse. Give us a lease for $1 a year, we'll maintain it. Again, the town was on board. The town supported the arts. About 10 years later, the town literally established the foundation for the art center that is out there today. Right? The town, the board, went and approved appropriation of $100,000 of community preservation funds to literally lift that barn up, put a new foundation under it, and set it back down so that we could actually have an art center. Again, we had the board's support. 2011, another $250,000 in community preservation funds committed to restoring that barn and making it into an art center. Matched by another $250,000 from the Hopkinton Community Endowment, non-tax dollars. HCA was formed in 2012. We sort of merged with the Cultural Arts Alliance. I still hear people talking about the CAA, now the HCA. We are a nonprofit, okay? Every dime that we generate goes back into the arts. We were formed to work with the Hopkinton Community Endowment in order to raise money to construct the art gallery and the performance space that's currently in place out there. And again, the town supported our efforts. You guys gave us a 20-year lease for $1 a year. We wouldn't be here. We wouldn't be able to do this if it wasn't for the board's vision and leadership to put in our center. 2014, we got another $114,000 in community preservation funds to further do work along the mark. And then separate from that, we came together, the Hopkins Center for the Arts and the HCE, and we independently, separate from the town, with no tax dollars, we raised $2 million. It was hard. It was very, very hard. And we did. We did it with generous donations from residents. We did it with a generous grant from the Massachusetts Cultural Council, from services that were done basically at cost by Barnum Gassett, Scott Richardson. And today we have a beautiful, beautiful facility. It is a gem. It is a reason people are moving to Hopkinton, and it's a reason why people are going to stay in Hopkinton. If you haven't seen it, and I know we've invited all of you out there to see it, I hope you'll come. That you'll see it is gorgeous. We have music classes, dancing, painting, acting, ceramics, filmmaking, even yoga. We have plays, we have musicals, we have open mic nights, we have be-free concerts where the high school kids can come in a drug and alcohol-free environment, play and listen to each other make music. We have events with the schools. We have high school honor art show every year. We have art space where middle schoolers can come after classes, but before the parents maybe get home from work. We invited the arts teachers, history teachers, and language teachers at the high school recently to come over and bring their classes over to see our current exhibit on integration and to speak with the arts. The benefit to the town and to the schools is tremendous, and the opportunities are tremendous. We work with the Respite Center. We give free classes to the Respite Center. We partner with the Senior Center. We do all of this on a shoestring budget. Again, 100% of the proceeds go back into the Arts Center. We have board members volunteering tens, if not hundreds of hours, all volunteer supporting this. We have minimal staff. We've got two fantastic co-directors, Kelly Grill and Chris Waldman, who work 50 to 60 hours a week and are paid more than enough. We only have one full-time staff member. What we can do, what we've started to do, and what we want to continue to do is simply not sustainable without rental income. It costs more than $900 a day to operate the art center. And we're not getting and we're not asking for a dime from the town taxpayers to support our operations. That's on us. We have some serious financial concerns. We want to make sure that we can make this art center as vibrant as the potential is. And all art centers have three different sources of income. They call it the three-legged stool. Okay, there's three legs here. One is donations and grants, one is programming, and the third is rentals. If you don't have any one of those three, it's still going to top a little
bit. Can I just jump in for a sec? So some of the topics that you're covering now, we've covered in the past, and I think they're widely understood. We have a lot of things that we need to talk about, I think, between where you are and where the
the town staff is at the moment. Plus, we have a lot of residents that want to make comments. So if you could kind of maybe get to more of the fresh information,
yeah.
And with the history, I think we've got a pretty good feel for.
But just to make it to the point, as Ray indicated, from the outset, we've been clear that we need rental income. That's how we're going to fund this place.
Understood.
So in 2016, we came in for the liquor license. To our surprise, the town took the position that we can't have any rentals. Whether or not there's alcohol, you're taking the position that there will be no rentals out there. You know, we're confident that we're allowed to under the current terms of our lease, but we're not looking for a confrontation. And so we've gone and looked and bent over backwards to try to reach some sort of an accommodation. And as I've indicated in the past, and I appreciate I said this, but there's a bigger audience now.
Yeah.
You know, we have opened ourselves up. We have talked to the superintendent of schools, talked to the police chief, the fire chief, talked to the town manager, town council, and we've gone to all the advisors to talk to them in an open manner to explain what we're trying to do out there. And if we need this income, and what we're trying to do is put a collar around it so that we can raise the money that we need, but do so in a responsible manner, in a manner that is respectful to our neighbors. So, what are we asking for? We've gone through it, we've heard the concerns, and we've identified what we can do to try to make sure that everything is done in a way that is open, respectful of the neighbors, et cetera, and keep control over this whole situation. First concern that we've heard was the number of events. All right. So there's 365 days in a year. We're proposing to voluntarily limit it to no more than 32 total events.
And they're at 30. I say they. I'm just trying to get some dialogue.
Yeah.
So 32 to 30. Okay.
We've broken it into 12 into large and small events. Large being over 100 participants. Small being under. For large events, no more than 12. For the number of people at an event, we're going to limit it at 250. Small events under 200. I mean, under 100 participants, we're proposing 20.
Where are we at?
I believe you're at 20.
Yeah.
What?
Right.
I'm sorry, we're at 10?
20 for the small, 10 for the large.
Got it.
And they're at 20.
Oh, and then 32, 30. Okay, it's overall. Okay.
We're at 150.
With respect to the 150, 250, you have to understand that we have to be competitive. You know, if someone wants to have a wedding with 200 people, that could be a significant revenue generator for us. It's about the size of a lot of the events that we have out there as it is. And, you know, we've been doing this for a year now. We checked with the chief. We haven't had a single complaint. A single complaint. Noise. No complaints, and we've had big groups out there. Another concern is weddings, has been expressed. So what we're proposing is that we have no more of the large events, no more than six would be weddings, of the small events, no more than six. Hours. What we're proposing is anything Sunday through Thursday will end by 10 p.m. Friday and Saturday will end by 11.
11?
11.
Okay.
Before we had talked about 11:30, we're working in good faith and trying our best to reach everyone halfway.
Okay.
Alcohol. First of all, we're not going to have alcohol at all events. Let me make that perfectly clear. All right? We are not seeking a liquor license. If a renter wants to have alcohol at an event, then they're going to have to comply with state and local law. All right? State and local law says that they have to use a licensed caterer, someone that's licensed with the ABCC, that is trained, that knows what they're doing, and has a license, their livelihood, literally on the line. All right? But we're not going to staffed properly so that there were no problems out there. The other option is to come back to this board and ask for a one-day liquor license, which you're familiar with. In fact, you approved without comment more earlier this meeting a one-day liquor license for St. John's, which I know is in a more residential area than we are. As far as alcohol, we've looked at it and we've decided that we will not have any alcohol outdoors at any of these events. Okay? What we've also are proposing, to give you some further comfort, we're proposing that if there's a wedding, we're gonna require that there be a police detail present. All right? At any large event, anything over 100 that has alcohol in it, we'll have a police detail there. Noise is another concern for us. Of course, we're going to comply with all local bylaws. The performance space is heavily insulated. It's also in the back, away from most of the neighbors. We're going to require that anyone that leaves promptly, and of course, we're going to have a police detail at any major events so that they can move people on the way as well. Again, we've been operating out there for a year. We haven't had a single complaint. None. Then liability. We already have a $1 million liability policy that we took out, that we paid for, that we named the town as an additional insured on. Any event with alcohol is going to have, if it's through an ABC licensed caterer, they have their own liquor liability policy. We're going to require that they make us an additional named insured, that they make the town an additional named insured. If it's through a one-day license, then the HCA will go and obtain a one-day license and we'll name you as an additional insured. So liability should not be an issue. So, in conclusion, we've all been working together to get a thriving arts center out there for 20 years. We finally have done it. We've done it because of the town's leadership. We've done it because of extremely generous donations from residents who know that this is a gem in town. Hard work of hundreds of volunteers and dedication to Chris and Kelly. I'm asking you to recognize that the town deserves a thriving art center. And you can't have it without these rentals. We're asking you to help us build again on the foundation that you laid. Allow us to do this. Recognize that reach for here in good faith. You've gone more than halfway. And we'd ask you to vote to approve the lease addendum along the lines of what I just outlined.
Okay, thank you. So in keeping with the process that we outlined and agreed to earlier, what we would do now typically is the Board of Selectmen would ask some sort of general questions, maybe some quick clarifications, not get into the details of any kind of deliberation, because that's after the public would speak. Because it's really the public's turn and it's the public's opportunity to come and share their thoughts tonight more than anything else. That's the primary objective of this hearing. So sort of with that guidance or request, does anybody, Mr. Tedstone, any general questions or overall sort of thoughts that you want to express at this time? We're going to come back to it later as a board, but right now, anything? Okay, Mr. Catino.
How many parking spaces? I remember that from the planning board.
I'm not aware of the number off the top of my head. I guess about 50. We have an agreement with the schools that we can use the high school, what's called the senior parking lot, in the event. We have and we met with Superintendent McCloud to revise that. I should have said one other thing that we're going to do is if there's an event with alcohol in it, we're going to cordon that parking lot off. That there can't be any cross-contamination. And the way it currently reads is that, of course, the school takes precedent. If they need that space, they have that space. We have a very good working relationship with the schools to make sure that we're all on the same page and there's
because I know from parent teacher nights that, you know, I've had to park across the street at the superintendent's office and stuff. And I just want to make, that's one of the things I was concerned about.
Parent teacher nights, our parking lot is full of cars.
Mm-hmm. Right.
Which we don't mind.
Yeah, because you know, if it was a restaurant, you'd need almost 90 spaces at 3 or 4 or something. That's one of the,
anything else?
No, I'll be fine.
Okay. Mr. Sestari.
Kurt, first of all, thanks for coming here tonight, and thanks for all the time and effort that you've been putting into this. I think that we've come a long way since the last meeting. Later, I certainly have a lot more comments. But the only question or clarification that I'm looking for right now is the HCA's comment on the board's ability to revoke the agreement.
Well, we are of the legal position that we have the right to go and do this anyhow. Okay? So, but if you want to put in something that would tear up this addendum in the event that you have, you know, you give us a hearing, and you give us a fair hearing, you hear the complaints, I don't think that we would have a significant issue with that.
Mrs. Wright.
Things go badly. I actually was a lot more comfortable with the addendum that our attorney had come up with. It had addressed a lot of my concerns, so this is a little different. Just a couple specific questions right now. Those hours that you proposed for the Sunday through Thursday, ending at 10 and Friday through Saturday at 11, are those the hours that the alcohol would stop being served, or are those the hours that the event would be over and people would leave? Because presumably there would be ongoing activity.
The event would be over at 11 or 10. We have not given consideration as to whether or not we stop the service of alcohol prior to that. That doesn't practically matter.
But if you continue to serve, then they're obviously going to stay there.
Oh, no, we're not serving past that time.
No, but I think the residents have the right to expect that if your closing time is 10 o'clock on a work night and a school night, that by 10 o'clock the car doors will stop slamming, people will leave. Not that you're going to stop serving at 10 and they'll be straggling out for another hour.
No, correct. So the idea is that 10 o'clock or 11 o'clock hour, lights are on, everyone's going on.
One other question right now. Events, there are kids out of the premises, kids leave the bus loop, they're coming home from sport practices, they're here for lessons and other events. How does this mesh if there are, say, would there be other parts of that building, other rooms being used that would be occupied by children? And also, where there are children in that general area for lessons or sports, usually when kids are anywhere in the vicinity or if there's any contact with children, there are Corey checks done to make sure that these children are in a safe environment. Would you be having an event that had something else going in an ancillary room or another part of the facility?
Well, I think there are 2 points there. First on Corey, and Corey check everybody. That's a concern. I mean, anyone that is volunteering or working for the HCA is Corey checked.
But a caterer that's in providing services and they're in that area where there are also children in the area.
Oh, I'm not aware of caterers being any worse offenders than anybody else, but certainly could check with the caterer to see whether they have Corey check their people as well, or ask them to only have Corey's people there that they've cleared.
I mean, my concern is reflecting a concern that has been expressed by others about the proximity to schools or school children or The same environment, creating the same environment that we usually expect
absolutely.
Where children are in the vicinity.
Of course, and that's why we met with Dr. Cloud to talk about these issues. We also met with the chief of police to talk about these issues. I mean, the chief is here, he can speak for himself, but my understanding is that there weren't any major concerns. When we were here, when we did apply for a liquor license, you know, the school board voted to not object to it. I mean, they know that we, I mean, there's not a lot of trust in what I'm hearing, and I can guarantee you that the safety of our kids, safety of my kids are in the HCA all the time. They go to the schools. All my kids' friends. We're not gonna. You know, we're going to protect them.
I just want to make one comment to that. The phrase "there's not a lot of trust." I hope you understand that it's the due diligence of any board to look for worst case scenario. Murphy's Law says, you know, the worst thing can happen. It's not a matter of trust. It's more really trying to anticipate where there could be a problem and to the best of one's ability guard against that. And I do feel that in a general sense, I have to take umbrage when there's an inference that if questions are raised at all around a good cause, that somehow one is opposed to that good cause. I've received just tons of letters of support from HCA. Everybody knows what an asset this organization is to the community. You'd have a heart of stone not to recognize what the HCA stands for, the contribution it makes to the community, what it says about this town. And so the very legitimate questions that are being raised are to protect the neighborhood, the town, make sure that this is used appropriately, particularly given its location. And it's not that someone is opposed to the arts, far from it.
Okay, let's do this. Let's move on to the public hearing portion of this. I think we've got a good feel from both sides kind of as to where we are, but we're really here tonight to hear from the public. So with that, Kurt, if you wouldn't mind just giving away the table there. Anybody that would like to address the board, the HCA, the town staff, is welcome to do so. As we all agreed to, this is a 2 or 3 minute comment period. And we ask that you join us at the table. Just state your name and address. Street is fine if you don't want to throw the number out there. And then we will take it from there. So with that, do we have any takers to share a couple of comments? Mr. Joseph, he's very good at 2 to 3 minutes. Intent.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. I just want to address two things that Mr. Patino brought up with regard to the parking. We have, I think it's 44 parking spaces on site with that. Many years ago, when I came before the board to make this proposal, one of the driving forces was that I had been on a high school building committee and all that, and we talked about the fact that we had hundreds of parking spaces there next to this facility, and the synergy would be remarkable in terms of if we were able to work in coordination with the schools, which we have worked out with Superintendent McCloud, that when there's not a major event at the schools, that we are able to use the adjacent parking spaces. And it's in the town's best interest. The town built the school, and the town owns the HCA. Why would we not share parking? All right, so I think that addresses that question. In our meeting with Superintendent McCloud this week, it was a great meeting, and she was very forthright and said, look, my only concern is the in and out if there's two events going on. With the parking and this alcohol being served, I want to make sure that if there's students going in and out that they're protected, that there's not any kind of incident. So we've agreed to cordon off, and we're looking at how we're going to do that on a temporary basis, be able to take it down, put it up, etc. And if there is an outside rental that has alcohol, that we would have a police detail there. She was more than happy with that. and also emphasize the now kinds of cross-curriculum that are going on. The other reason we built the Art Center there was we have grades 4 through 12 within walking distance. So in just in the past couple of weeks, we had a major photography show there where the high school classes during school hours walked over and were able to see this powerful exhibit on immigration. That kind of synergy, and that was why we are there. That's why we are there. And I know we're talking about 150 versus 250 later on and all this. And it occurred to me, we just granted a one-day liquor license to St. John's. Are they limited to 150 there? Because it seems to me if they're not, there's a double standard being applied. And I think we need to think about that. All right, this is an asset that primarily was built with after-tax dollars by the citizens of Hopkinton. And I think I want to make sure that the selectmen understand that this is something that we need your support on. We're not asking for anything outrageous. We're really asking for common sense rules and regs. We're doing everything we can to work with you to make sure we can get there. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Joseph. Anybody else? Hi.
Hi, Barbara Kessler. Bob, 81 Hayden Rowe Street, so I'm literally right across the street from the schools and from the HCA. I've been involved with the HCA since I moved to town in 2003 as a performer, as a mom of other performers and students. I'm also a volunteer there. I run the open mic monthly as a volunteer. I've also been a paid employee as a recipient of some of the grant money that they've received to do good services with the middle schoolers. So I've had it. Every experience, I know how it works. It's a great organization, and I want to just lend my support wholeheartedly. I think this is a great opportunity. I respect the board's concerns that were just brought up as a watchdog in this town, which is much appreciated as a resident. But I think the opportunity for growth now is to really allow the HCA to shine fully on its own merits without any more taxpayer dollars, but actually using what they've built, this beautiful space, to grow the town to an even better place that you will then, you know, be proud to be a watchdog of. I am very firmly appreciative of the watch guard attitude, but also feel really confident as a neighbor, as a participant, and as a mom in the area that this will only do good for the town and for the HCA, certainly. So I just wanted to express that really, really clearly. And that's it. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Mr. Harrow.
Thank you.
Hi.
So, firstly, I'm a live performance arts supporter. I go to live performance arts a lot. I enjoy that. I like what the HCA is doing. I like the concept. I have some concerns. If this was a private operation and they wanted to do this near the school, I think the issues would be considerably different. But I think the town residents, if I've added it up right, have put in about $500,000 to the basis of this operation. And we rent it out for $1 a year. If we're going to agree to this, then I think that the town should get an increase in the rent, in fact, a percentage of the take. I don't know what it is, but I would feel better if that were the case. And then I thought I heard a comment about $1 million in liability maximum. Is that the actual number?
It is.
Some of you may know that I work with kids and I do after-school enrichment programs, and I have stopped doing business in some towns because they wanted me to carry $3 million in liability insurance. So if little Ed had to carry $3 million, I wonder if $1 million is enough for the town.
Thank you.
Just at one point.
Hang on one sec. This is the time for the public to come forward without getting caught up in the middle of a debate. Sometimes people don't like that, and we can come back to it. Anybody else want to come up and say hello?
Hello.
Hi.
I'm Phil Antonio, and I also live in Hayden Rowe. I've been a professional musician for 40 years. I have conservatively programs is pretty high in doing this. I can tell you that without alcohol, that might be a little more difficult to rent that room. I can tell you from witnessing 1,000 events, they seldom get that out of control. And when you start adding in the idea of a police detail, I think you've just basically drawn the line and keeping things completely under control. I want to express that, yes, we're in a school zone, but we're being highly respective of the fact that the kids are there or not there. And when they're not there, that's when something will probably happen. And I think that makes perfect sense. I also think that we need to give as much latitude as possible for the ACA to get over the hump of fundraising and get into self-sufficiency. And everyone knows that's going to be difficult for everyone these days. And lastly, the only thing I wanted to mention was that I think we have to draw a line. I totally understand your concerns about core checks, but I was thinking to myself, well then do we need to core check every single person who shows up to a football game because they're in proximity of kids? I think we need to draw a line somewhere that says, you know, I think you're right. Will these events be mixed? Of course not. I think if it needs to be stipulated that these events don't happen when other events are happening in the building, then maybe that's something that has to happen. But I think having a police officer present, I think it's pretty much going to draw a line at running another level of safety check on these events that they're proposing. And that's it.
Great. Thank you for your time. Anybody else? So when we close the public hearing, we close the public hearing, right? And we all agree to that, I think. So everybody's good? Okay. So with that, the chair will entertain a motion. I'm sorry, Mr. Kamal.
Through the chair. In my conversations with the members, I had referenced the term of the agreement being an issue for discussion. Just wanted to check with town council where that conversation is.
Okay, so the addendum says that the term of the agreement is 1 year. And it has a provision to automatically renew for four additional 1 year terms unless somebody makes an affirmative, gives an affirmative notice of termination. So if prior to the end of the 1 year term, if you want to terminate the agreement, you may do so by giving notice. Otherwise it will automatically renew for an additional year. And that goes out to 5 years, and then at the end of 5 years, we'll have to negotiate something new.
Okay.
And that's being left in at this point. That's not under contention.
That is not under contention, to my knowledge. There were 2 points that I listed as being under contention that didn't get mentioned in the discussion so far. One is that we had our most recent version of the addendum limited it to beer and wine, and my understanding is that HCA does not want that limit, and our version of the addendum includes an approval by the town manager, which I believe the HCA is objecting to, but neither of those got mentioned in Kurt's presentation, so I just want to make sure it's clear.
So I get the beer, wine thing, and all alcohol, but I don't understand the approval of the town manager for what?
For the independent
kind of beer
events.
They're gonna. I mean, okay.
No.
What's he gonna approve? I love him, but what's he gonna approve? What is he gonna approve?
The events.
Each individual event.
That's correct.
That's in effect having the Board of Selectmen approve each individual event. All right, we're not gonna debate it right now. Okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
That's why we came to you for guidance.
Gotcha. Okay. All right, so I didn't close the public hearing because they threw a couple things out there. Does anyone have any comments that you want to make before we close the public hearing?
Motion to close.
Okay, we have a motion to close the public hearing.
Second.
And a second. Any discussion? All those in favor?
Aye.
Okay, so with that, we'll now try to sort of slide to the next phase of this. Although, having done this for going on 10 years now, or whatever that number is, 9 years now, I would suggest that we consider trying a different approach here. We have a professional team of individuals here that has a list of things they're trying to discuss with the applicant and the professional folks over there, and they have a sort of separate list of things that's on their list that they're trying to sort out. So we still have, in my view, a fairly robust discussion that needs to take place to sort out these two lists. And I don't know if it's going to be productive for this board to try and get into the details of every item that's on your list and compare it with every item on his list and go back and forth, because we will be here for hours. So what I would suggest that the board consider is that the board consider some form of motion to authorize the town manager and town council to continue negotiations and bring back as soon as possible a negotiated agreement that both parties have agreed to in principle prior to a review by the Board of Selectmen.
Mr. Chair.
What's the story?
I would offer that I think the board needs to have some level of discussion on this topic tonight in order to give what we feel is the appropriate guidance to those parties to go back and negotiate.
I think we can work that into the process I described, if that's, if you're open to that. In other words, you share your concerns, your thoughts, and then say, put this on your list, make sure that you get this worked on.
Well, yeah, I think in the end, but I think that I'm hoping that there's a good possibility we would be able to come to some type of a verbal agreement tonight, which could then be codified in the actual written agreement, and we all go off knowing that this is in good hands, and the next meeting we'll have something to sign.
Okay. Any other thoughts on the process we're going to be kicking around?
I agree with.
Okay, so let's, let me try and just sort of restate that and clarify and make sure that you're in agreement too. What I think we should do is each member should share their specific concerns based on where this group is and that group is, and say these are my hot buttons, whatever they are, and ask that they get worked into what gets resolved between now and the time they come back for a signed document. Does that make sense? Okay. You know what I'm saying? This is right?
Yeah.
You good? So I'm not trying to usurp us deliberating and making it, voting it tonight, but I just don't see it happening. I mean, it's 9:10.
I think we need to be open to that possibility, though.
If we blow through it and everybody melts over here and form comes together, I'm all for it, but I don't see it happening.
Mr.
Yeah?
There is so much that was in this addendum document that was produced by our town council, and then there are so many points that were contradicted or alternatives offered by the HCA that I just couldn't see this board not having this in writing and seeing exactly what we're talking about. If it was one or two points, that would be one thing. But, I mean, there's all kinds of meat in here that I'm still not even clear whether this stays in or that doesn't stay in. I need to see it.
Yeah.
It's too much.
From a different angle, I think you're making the same point that I'm making.
Yeah.
So what are the two parties, quote unquote, feel about what we're thinking at this moment?
Through the chair, I think it may be helpful to receive guidance from the board on the following issues. The number of events, the size of the events, the hours of operation, whether this is all alcohol served or is strictly beer and wine. And then finally, whether there's need for the town manager to approve engineering. So that's the list that I have right.
You give me guidance on those things, we can get a deal done.
Okay, so that's what we're trying to sort through here now. We're starting to get somewhere. Kurt, you just heard what the town manager had to say. What do you think?
I'm happy to walk through there. I mean, we need our own board vote before we finally agree anything. But we have met with the directors, and on those points, there are some points that we just cannot concede on. So I'm happy to have the discussion and see where we can agree to and where we can't. And then we can know where we're moving.
Do you mind sharing which points you wouldn't be able to concede on?
We cannot concede. The whole point of this agreement is to set up parameters so that we don't have to come back to the board or to the town manager for every single event.
Okay.
That's non-negotiable.
So the town manager approval is one. Okay. I think you have one vote supporting there.
In order to have weddings, we need beer, wine, and liquor.
I'm sorry?
We need beer, wine, and liquor.
So you need an all alcohol, basically.
Those are the big ones. And then the size, you need at least 250. 150 is not enough.
Okay. So we have 250 all alcohol through caterers, and the town manager is not weighing on each event. Mrs. Wright.
I didn't completely hear what Mr. Foligno said about the all alcohol. Did you say for weddings we need all alcohol, or did you say we need all alcohol for everything? Maybe that's a different situation where you allow it for weddings, but you go beer and wine for the others. I'm not quite sure what I heard you say.
Well, the main reason we want all alcohol is certainly for weddings. There could be other events, specific events, that it might be called for. But I'm not saying that we're going to have alcohol at every... First of all, we're not going to have alcohol at every event anyhow.
Right.
But if there is alcohol, even if it's not a wedding, you know, there, sometimes it might have alcohol, sometimes it might just be beer and wine. It could be a wedding that they just want beer and wine. You just need that flexibility in order to keep this as a rental space, just like any others, just like St. John's has when they have weddings. You know, we need that flexibility.
So you're looking for all alcohol across the board?
I think you got to leave that flexibility.
The ability to have, correct.
Okay, so we have three issues that are sort of like deal breakers. And then we have four other issues, I believe it was, or maybe five other issues that Mr. Camallo articulated that we can go back and forth a little bit to try and resolve. So the issues that those, how many did you have, Mr. Camallo? Eight?
Let me count,
yeah.
Yeah, it's six.
Okay, can you read those six out one more time, please?
Yeah, number one is the number of events.
Total number of events.
Yes, number two is the size of the events.
Meaning 150 to 250.
Yes, number three is the hours of operation.
Okay.
Four, all alcohol versus beer and wine. And then number five is town manager's approval. Liability. Yeah, number five. Yes, number six is liability.
Number six is liability. Yes. And is number seven an exit clause inside the agreement timeline for, you know, serious events to take place?
What I heard from the HCA is that they are not opposed to that provision.
Okay. Yeah. All right. So we have six items that seem to be focused on, a lot of the energy is and concern is focused around those six. Does the board have any other items they want to add to that list of six of consequence?
Can we just bring them up when we make our comments and ask questions?
Yeah, but I guess I don't see us going. That's
we haven't had a chance to talk. If we get a chance to, you know, talk about this a little bit, we can see how it's moving.
All right. Okay. But I hope to be proved wrong, but I'm not convinced it's going to be productive. So why don't you go ahead and start?
I will. Thank you, Mr. Chair. First of all, I want to thank everybody from the HCA for, you know, continuing to work with us and work on this issue right from day one. I mean, you know, beyond this past spring. Chuck, Kelly, you guys have carried this torch incredibly over the years. You know, I was on many of those boards that Kurt was mentioning where we voted to support you. I know that it wasn't always a smooth road between our board and your organization, but we've gotten there and we want to continue to help you be a viable organization, just as everybody else wants. Kurt, I appreciate your efforts on this. You've done great things for the town and in other roles as well, bringing your professional capabilities. And I think that you and town council have worked together well to really bring us down the road so far. And I am hopeful that we can, in concept, close this out tonight so that you and town council can hammer out the actual verbiage behind the agreement and we can move on and put ink on paper at the next meeting. You know, I've kind of gone through a roller coaster today. You know, when Mr. Miaris was talking about the proposal from the town, you know, I started thinking to myself, wow, you know, this is great. You know, this is more than I could have imagined. And, you know, and then, you know, we heard the response. And all of a sudden my heart sank. And I was thinking to myself, we are still so far apart. This is not going to happen tonight. I definitely held the same view as Mr. Herr. But Kurt, as you walked through everything and you started talking about what your counter proposal was, I really don't think that we're that far off. I look at the events, 30 versus 32, that's fine. You know, that's a negligible difference. As far as how many weddings there are, you know, I don't care if every one of them is a wedding, personally. It's not the focus of, you know, or the function of the event that really matters to me. It's, again, focusing on public safety. When we start getting down to the hours, you know, at first I started having a little bit of a problem with the Sunday through Thursday at 10. When we started looking at the alcohol, beer and wine versus full alcohol, I was having a problem there too. But then you brought out the police required card. And that just allays so many of my concerns and my fears right there. I know that we've got an incredible police department. I know that they're incredibly focused on alcohol awareness and safety in our town. People are scared to drive through our town if they've had a couple of beers after work at a bar. And, you know, that makes me feel good. You know, it makes me feel safe. It makes me feel that when my kids are on the road, they're that much safer. I have no question that for the events that are over 100 people and for all of these weddings, that if we have one of our police officers there, we have the best chance of things being safe as we can. I have a little bit of an issue with the separation in size, the 150 to 250. I'd love to see if we could meet in the middle at 200. But you know, in general, you know, I think that we are very, very close on this. You know, I'm not even going to bring up any negatives and comments toward other comments that were made. I think that we're there. You know, again, I'd love to see the 250 come to 200, but in general, I think that we're so close, and I think that I'd love to have an agreement tonight where we can go ahead and put this in paper.
Okay.
One last comment. As far as town manager approval, to Mr. Herr's point, I love Mr. Camallo. I respect everything that he does for the town. I think that he's, you know, he's been an incredibly positive force for the town over the last 8 years. But I don't think that there needs to be approval for individual events. And I think that it does kind of go around the spirit of the agreement and the purpose of the agreement. And one last final thing that I was thinking of on this, was as far as termination of the agreement, termination of the addendum. From my personal view, and if we wanted to put it into the agreement somehow, I mean, I would hold you to the same standards as other liquor license holders. And, you know, we're not going to take a license away from one offense, but if there are repeated offenses, that's when I would start considering termination of the agreement. And I'm pretty confident that regardless of, you know, you having your interpretation of the lease and us having our interpretation of the lease, if it gets to that point where the addendum is terminated for that reason, if we did end up, you know, I hope we don't, but if we ended up going to court to really settle it, I think that we would have a little bit more weight on our side, but I don't expect that.
Mr.
Thank
Pedestal.
You, Mr. Chair.
All right, well, I echo some of Mr. Sestari's comments, and Mr. Fleegoff, thank you also for doing all your legwork on this. So my job, as I see it as a selectman, is to not speak for what I wanted to have, but for what I perceive the public to be interested in. I had a little bit of time today, so I went over these emails that I've gotten from the town, from my Board of Selectmen email. So the letters that I got as of 1800 hours, 6 o'clock p.m., I had 34 letters from people that were pro the addendum of the lease. Of those 34, 21 of those attached their address, so I can safely assume that they were town residents. Of those 21, 5 were abutters. So I had Mr. DeBona, Mr. and Mrs. Swenson, Mr. Masters, Mr. Penfield, all resounding pro lease addendum. The fifth one was Dr. Bays, who was in favor of it, but he had stipulations, a few stipulations in his letter, but still in favor of it. I had one, so out of the 35 letters that I read on email, I had one con. One, that con was a resident, and that con wasn't a butter, and it was Mrs. Hagen. So the public sentiment to me is that the public wants this to happen. Personally, I also want it to happen, but I'm not speaking for me personally. I'm speaking for me as a selectman, where I'm taking the information that I've gotten and how I perceive public, the town wants. When it comes to the breakdown, the 32 verse 30, you know, I can't imagine that it would be a deal breaker if we came to 31. Or if we did go to 32, then maybe instead of 250, we go to 200. You know, there's language that you and Mr. Mayeres are so much further schooled on me than me on this, that I trust that you guys can hammer it out. The size of events, the hours of operation. The all alcohol versus beer and wine, my thought on this may not be popular with the board or may not be popular with many, but I'm a believer of this. When it comes to liquor licenses, I believe it should be liquor like alcohol or no alcohol. So I've seen many people fall over on wine drunk. I've seen many people fall over on gin drunk. When you fall over, I don't know if you can get any drunker on wine than you can on gin than you can on wine. I understand you can do it a little bit quicker probably, but so I'm not opposed to the all alcohol. The hours of operation, I do feel pretty strongly that the weekdays should be 9 o'clock. I like the fact that we would remove this from town manager's approval. And that said, I don't think that we're that far apart based on the issues that have been brought to us. I can't imagine you'd want to delay this for X amount of months over one event or two events. The 150 to 250, that's a significant amount. I understand that that's something probably worth fighting for, but the 30 to 32, that's negligible. The hours of operation, as I said, all the other points are points that I think that I trust that you and Mr. Mayeres can hash out rather quickly, and that's all I have on that.
Mr. Coutinho.
Well, I also got the same 35 letters, and I know if this was a year and a half ago, my mother would have sent one to me also. saying, John, just get this thing done. But that being said, and I think the reason why we're going through so many of these issues is, if it were a liquor license, all that stuff is written. All that stuff, where, you know, the liability, all these issues that we're concerned about, the parking and the hours of operation and everything else, that's all spelled out by Mass General Law and then some of our additional bylaws. So, you know, I think that this is important if we're doing a sort of like a license approval kind of thing, that this is why we're going through all of these things. And I think that we've, with this discussion, we've hammered out most of them. I agree with my two colleagues, the number, size, and everything. But the one that I'm going to agree with, the Ed Harrow that came up, is the liability. Because I even just think about, $1 million liability, even in my construction business and stuff. You know, you have to take carry 3 to 5. And I know that the difference in the bond for that will probably be like $10 or something. Yeah.
Let's get through it,
yeah,
first.
So, yeah, so that
be a few other comments,
when it comes down to it, originally I was one of those people that said, you know, beer and wine only, but I understand with the weddings and such, you really, you need the alcohol. And to his point, somebody's going to get drunk, they're going to get drunk. And then the exit clause, if you guys are all set with that. So... I appreciate all the work that everybody's doing, and I can hear my mother in my head saying, just be quiet and get this done. So I'll go on.
Good advice.
So be quiet.
Mrs. Wright.
Yeah, you know, as I said before, I was very pleased with the first addendum agreement that Town Council had worked out. It really addressed almost all of my concerns from the previous evening. Having said that, I agree very much with what Mr. Sestari has said, as well as Mr. Catino, relative to the liability issue. I, too, received those 36 letters, and I read them all. Many of them, the bulk of the letter, focused on the wonderful work that the HCA does and the good cause that it is. I don't think there's any argument about that. I think we all recognize that. Again, the issue here is protecting the residents, protecting the town. With that in mind, I think the hours are something that needs to be looked at carefully. Mr. Bays had mentioned at 9 o'clock on weekdays. I've heard other residents about butters say that, you know, these are school nights, work nights. At the very least, as I mentioned to Mr. Fleegoff earlier, there should be some understanding of when this shuts down and when that parking lot can be expected to clear out, particularly on a weeknight, a school night. And I'm pleased to hear that you are amenable to some kind of an exit clause. Again, mentioning that I see our role as watchdog to protect the town in all aspects of it. And, it might be not a termination. It might be a renegotiation based on experience. But the town needs to be protected to have some recourse if things do not go swimmingly, despite our best hope. Particularly with respect to weddings. I was at a wedding this weekend, and it wasn't a matter of over drinking. The music was so loud, not only could you not have a conversation, you couldn't even yell into the other person's ear. And I went out into the parking lot to get something from my car. All the windows and doors were shut because it was a cold, rainy weekend. You could hear the music out in the parking lot. The whole building was thumping with this music. The wedding problem could be a problem with noise. Might not have anything to do with alcohol. There needs to be some opportunity for review to make sure that if things are not as we expect, that we do have some recourse for the sake of everyone. So that's kind of where I'm coming from right now.
Okay, so sort of the hot buttons for me are the time, the closing time, or the event end time, whatever that we're calling it,
10 o'clock seems a little late, kind of midweek. Mm-hmm. Friday, Saturday doesn't seem to bother me as much, but 10 o'clock seems a little late midweek, so maybe we can adjust that a little. I'm curious, maybe I missed something along the way here, but in terms of the town manager approving the events, how did that come to be? What's the rationale behind that? Assuming there's rationale behind it.
Yes, if I may. This came from the board's previous comments for tighter oversight on the events.
Okay. All right.
So we're the ones who threw you in front of the bus tonight?
Yeah, I don't remember throwing you out there.
Yes.
But,
yeah.
Anyway, so I struggle with that. If we're going to do this and hash out this agreement, we're going to do this and hash out the agreement, there's going to be an exit clause in it, then I don't think we need another party sticking their nose into it yet again at every event. I mean, I don't think that's appropriate. So I struggle with that. I'm struggling with the 10 o'clock midweek. I'm okay with 11 o'clock on the weekends. And those are sort of my hot button items. Okay, so that's round one of everybody sort of downloading what they're thinking and feeling at the moment. So Kurt, you had a couple of questions you wanted to respond to or comments? Yeah, sure.
First, I'm not sure if we have an issue with liability. I mean, the rule that the board has for a one-day liquor license is to get a $1 million liability policy naming the town as sufficient insurer. That's what the board looks at. Mm-hmm. Okay. Incidentally, the town, I know Ray knows this, under the Mass Torts Claims Act, I used to do a ton of this work, has $100,000 limit. So if it's a negligence claim, you're covered 10 times over. All right. So that's what we're proposing. I'm not sure if there's a disconnect there or if that's a problem. That's what we require.
So let's try and check this one off. So the one-day liquor license requires $1 million liability policy, correct?
You can just make that number up.
I'm sorry?
That's where we took it from.
Yeah, so you got it from there.
Oh, okay. I'm fine with it.
And that is in line with ABCC, right?
Yes.
Okay. Does anybody have any other additional comments, concerns about this piece of the puzzle? If that's what we're already requiring, and why would we do this any different? Okay, so there's some feedback on that. All right. Next, Kurt.
On the size 150 versus 250, I mean, if there's no requirements being put on St. John's, we need that flexibility to land these weddings.
Let's let them go through, and I will come back.
So that's a real, real issue for us. On the hours, I think we could probably concede to 9:30 is what the difference between 9 and 10 o'clock, which you had proposed during the week. I would note that currently on non-rental events, we have rehearsals and things going out there, 10, sometimes 10:30. That's not subject to this agreement. I mean, I think there's a recognition by the board that we can do our art things out there and that this is not part of that.
Mm-hmm.
So I just want to flag that there may be activity out there past that time. It's not going to be a rental activity.
Okay. So let's try and solve that one real quick, too. I'm trying to just capitalize on the ones that I think we can solve. The 9:30 that you're suggesting as a sort of compromise for midweek, Monday through Thursday events, Sunday evening through Thursday evening, 9:30 p.m. shutdown for the events. How does that sit with everybody?
Can I make a suggestion?
Sure.
In keeping with comments that we've had, you may want to say, as an additional requirement, that alcohol service ends a half an hour before, and the parking lot needs to be cleared out half an hour after.
Yeah, I think that I'm happy saying that. I think that's kind of like a matter of practice for these companies anyway, because they got to get their staff out of there and all too. But anyway. Okay, so thank you. What do you guys think about 9:30 for Sunday to Thursday with a half hour prior close of the bar?
Kurt, are you amenable to that? Shutting the alcohol off at 9, getting you guys out of there by 9:30?
Okay. mean, as a practical matter, I don't think there are going to be many rental units that are some day.
Yeah, right.
I wouldn't think you'd blow it on a.
I'd be very surprised. Yeah. Mm-hmm. But yes, if there are.
Yeah, I mean, I was fine with 10. You know, my personal feeling is that, you know, where you start getting into any kind of danger zone is with the bigger events coming out and being loud. But the bigger events, there's going to be a police officer there again. And even if it's during the event and things are getting loud, someone's going to get on the phone to the police department and say, you know, it's past 9 o'clock and things are getting loud. And they're going to radio to whoever's there, and he's going to say, look, you got to keep it down, or I'm going to shut it down. I'm just not concerned. To me, again, the police detail takes such a weight off my shoulders with this. So
9:30 with a half hour prior close of bar? Everybody
yeah,
should?
It's a half hour, because it's I know from being a bartender, you need, and they need at least a half hour to clear out. So, yeah. So if they're out of there by 10. So closing the liquor at 9, closing the event at 9:30, and then clearing out by 10.
And for during Fridays and Saturdays, we got 11 p.m. and so we would knock off the service at 5:30.
Then out of there by 11:30.
So if you're knocking it off by 10:30, you can have everyone out of there by 11. Last door shut at 11 o'clock.
Or if close the turn the lights on and say get the heck out.
Yeah.
Well, it's the same. It would be the same thing, if I may.
Sure.
The 10:30, 11:30 out of the parking lot.
Oh, 11:30. Oh, yeah.
Yeah. That's the half hour.
Well, then we're not really conceding yet.
I'm hoping.
No, you can see the self-serving at 10:30.
I think he's just saying that, you know, you turn the lights on at 11. You know, people are going to be, you know, wandering around saying good luck to the bride.
We have to give them.
So are we good on the hours in principle? Mm-hmm. Right, because again, I think they still got to massage us a little bit in writing to come back to us in writing. So we're good on hours? Okay.
All alcohol.
So, Mr. Kamalo, are we good with taking the town manager's approval out of this process?
I strongly recommend that. Based on the comments from
I strongly recommend you keep it in or you get rid of it.
Yes, but again, the idea was based on the best previous comments, have some notice to the town.
You always have a full voice at this board, anytime. Okay, so we're going to take that one out. Okay, what does that leave?
Size of the big events.
Yes.
The number of events.
Now, the number of events is
32.
The difference between 30 and 32 is
two.
Yeah, it's a small difference.
Okay, so let's just stay focused here.
Between 36 and 30, I was thinking that was a small difference. The 32 and 30 is okay. A really small difference.
Yep.
So they're asking for 32. We're asking for 30. Are we willing to go to 32 because we got to figure out a couple of other things?
Yeah, with the caveat that says maybe Mr. Sligoff can bend a little bit as well as we head to the next year.
That's what we're going to work on here. I'm trying to prove that I was wrong and Mr. Sestari was right and we can get this resolved tonight. Mr. Kamalo, you were eyeballs lit up there when I said 32.
I think the board may want to discuss the size of the events.
Okay, we're going to get to that.
Before settling on the number
okay,
of events.
Fair enough.
Yeah.
Mr. Mayari, is anything on 30 to 32 really jumping out at you?
No, there's nothing that's jumping out at me. Just note that the additional two, as proposed by the HCA, are in the wedding category. We have 10 weddings and they're saying 12.
Okay. All right, I think we're okay there. So size of the events remains outstanding?
No, all alcohol versus beer wine.
All alcohol, beer wine question.
Yeah. That's it.
And what else?
That's it.
Mr. Marys, anything else?
No, I think that's all.
Mr. Kamal?
That's all.
Kurt?
I think we're good.
Well,
Okay. All right. So, let's try and tackle the beer, wine, alcohol thing first. I don't know. I mean, alcohol is alcohol. If you drink six beers or you drink six vodka tonics, at least for me anyway, you got a problem. I'm not in good shape then, night, and I'm Mr. not in good Her? Shape the next day. So, whether I don't have a strong personal opinion about beer, alcohol, or all alcohol. It's alcohol, and I just think, you know, I can see a lot of the art events or events that come in and they've got art up and I mean, that's, you go anywhere in Massachusetts, they're serving beer and wine at those things. They're not doing tequila shots. But, you know, there's I think there's a reasonable expectation or a reason, it's reasonable to give them some flexibility to have other refreshments at these events.
Especially at a wedding.
Yeah, I mean, I don't see them turning this into a big shooter's place, but, you know, I think they should have some flexibility there. That's my view anyway.
Yeah, if I may, that's one of the things I wanted to talk with. Now with these events, you know, for openings and such, or plays that might be going on or some other things, you know, beer and wine could, for me, I believe they could be served, but, you know, and not hit this 30, because I've never been to a gallery opening without the glass of wine.
Can I just clarify? Yeah. This lease is not addressing HCA logistic events. This is addressing rental events. So.
Yeah, that's a fair point. I brought that up. Sorry.
Okay.
Yeah, that already exists. They can already do
okay,
that.
Okay, go ahead. I just wanted to make sure that
celebrations.
Okay.
For rent.
Sure. Yeah, okay.
Mr. Chair?
Function.
Yeah. Mr. Sestari.
If we did some subset of the large events, some subset, you know, up to 250 and the rest 200, would you have a number in mind there? Can we split that down the middle? Say six up to 250, six up to 200, not to complicate things, but.
Did we finish the all alcohol thing?
I apologize.
I just want to make sure. I'm just trying to wrap each one up, chip it away here.
I'm just wondering how long you've been having six drinks a night.
Not long enough. It's not going to happen tonight at this rate.
It's close in time.
All alcohol.
I'm fine with all alcohol. Again, I, you know, with the
all alcohol, alcohol, Claire.
I mean, this whole thing, I'd like to find ways to scale it back and limit it, but that's just where I'm coming from. So.
Okay. All right, so we're gonna direct our team that all alcohol is in play. Okay? Do you have a strong opinion about that in either way? Other than what you've heard from the board previously?
No.
Okay. All right. And now the drum roll, please. We're down to 250 versus 150. On the large.
For 12 events per year.
So walk through the sizing again and how that works so we can all make sure we're on the same page here.
Sure. So what we broke it down was somewhat arbitrarily over 100 we call large, under 100 we call small. And as far as the number of events, what we proposed was 12 large, 20 small. Question is, of the large, of the 12 large, what is the maximum number? And what we're asking for is 250, because that'll allow us to have, you know, good-sized weddings, but not ridiculous weddings, allow us to be competitive, allow us to bring this in. And again, the fact is, today we proved for St. John's to have
Mr. Sestari.
First of all, I'd just like to address the St. John's thing. And while it's probably something we should be keeping in mind in terms of setting a size limit on those in the future, the size, I think, relates also to the size of the hall, as well as the fact that every time St. John's wants to have something, they need to come to us. So they're getting the one-day permits. With respect to this particular size, I am going to make a bit of a 180 here. And as I'm listening, I'm thinking to myself, if somebody comes into you tomorrow and says they want to have a wedding with 150 people, you're going to take it. And that's counting against the 250. So, you know, while I realize there may be a bumper crop 1 year and you're going to have 10 out of the 12 being at 250, you know, that's great for you. But in my mind, I'm thinking chances are it's probably going to be a pretty even split above and beyond above and below 200. And so it's not something that concerns me all that much. I would just, police chief, I'd like to ask a question of our police chief. Chief, is there any type of metric that you go by where, you know, events with more than 200 people, you would like to have more than one police officer, or are you comfortable with 250 people having one police officer? You think it would be? Okay. If you think it's good, then I'm good.
I would just note, as far as occupancy, we've got 350 for the performance space that it can house, and for this upstairs space, we have 175. So what we're proposing is well under the maximum capacity.
Yeah, and so the seating occupancy versus the standing occupancy?
So the performance space, 206 seated with tables and chairs, up to 350 with seating/standing. And then the second floor open space, 105 seated, 175 seating and standing.
So if you were having a wedding that was going to have a seated dinner, essentially you'd be limited to 206 anyway.
Correct.
Thank you.
Oh, 206, that's the number?
That, I mean, if it's going to be a sit-down wedding, that's our...
Oh, okay. That's
what we're
going to do
anyhow.
So, okay. Anything else?
No, I would just like to say that I'm comfortable with everything we've laid out tonight. And, you know, if the rest of the board is comfortable with the parameters that have been put down, I'm comfortable with voting on it.
You just want to win.
Always.
Mrs. Wright.
Yeah, the size issue with comparison with St. John's is kind of negated by the fact that can be changed at any time. If there were repeated problems with that site, we wouldn't continue to issue that. My issue is always recourse if things don't go well. This is something new. I personally, 250 is a big wedding. 150, that's a nice average size wedding. It's not small, it's not large. I would be happier if there are a lot of things that have been asked that it appears are going to be granted. Come a long way from where we started, come a long way even from what's in this addendum. As far as numbers, I would be more comfortable if we did that first year as a trial, sort of somewhat scale back on either size or numbers of large events, to be revisited at the 1 year period when there's a chance to review how the year has gone and how these events have gone to determine whether that number can be bumped up to either the larger number or larger number of the larger number events. That would be a trial period to prove the point that there will not be problems with this. And if there are, can be considered. That would be my recommendation.
Okay. Mr. Catino.
I'm good with it. But the part that I don't get is that...
Meaning up to 250?
Yeah, the up to 250, but it only sits two seats, two, seated wedding, so 206, then by law, the
I suppose they could have an event that is without the tables, and stand up and chairs, something along those lines, but conceivably, if you get bigger than that, it would be within the occupancy. But again, as a practical matter,
said that we're not encouraging you to break any laws by occupancy laws by allowing 250 if 206 is all you can do.
So what would happen if someone came to you and said we want to have a wedding for 248 people?
You say you're not able to have tables, so you sure you want to rent for us?
Sure.
But that's in the new performance center, correct? It's 206 in that performance center. Couldn't you put some nice tables out in the hallway? I mean, that's a big hallway right down the center of the hall and put another 20 there.
Put the bad tables out in the hall? The in-laws?
So for these big events, though, I was there Saturday night for an event upstairs in the barn, the original barn. The Enjoy Life Club held a meeting there, and it was great. The events wouldn't go up into there, though, would they? Into that space, like that little area?
That's a smaller space.
Yeah.
There were a small event of 20.
Yeah, but would a spillover, would a 248 go up into that space, kind of removed from the other main... But in terms of the alcohol control, though, you know, you've got everybody downstairs, 230 people downstairs, and I get the bride's going to have some champagne upstairs getting dressed, whatever. But you're not going to have a separate bar up there for the 20 people that are hanging around up there, 10 of whom might be questionable in age, and know that if they go up there, they can slip by, right? So I guess I'm looking for... If we're going to have a big event, we got to control where it is in the building or on the property so you can see what's going on from one vantage point and not have, because you can get lost in that place too, right? Okay. Mr. Joseph.
Mr. Chairman, there is a physical setup for a bar upstairs. So if we had a very large event, a wedding or some type of celebration, and they wanted to have hors d'oeuvres and drinks upstairs,
right, okay, I got you. Yeah, okay, got you. Mr. Kamal, I'll come back.
In terms of the weddings, will there be any tables in the outside sitting area? Okay. Not necessarily serving beer, but food. Will you serve food in the outside sitting area?
I suppose we can't rule that out. We are agreeing that we're not going to have any alcohol service out there or drinking. So, if it's a wedding, we're going to go inside and drink and go outside and eat and gamble.
Yeah.
I don't know.
Yeah. So, in that regard, if I may, Mr. Chair,
sure.
A couple of quick comments. Granted, there's unanimity on the part of the board that the town manager will not be approving the events. What I want to make sure, just to be clear, on the practical side, we have to monitor this process. So you will still be giving notice to the town manager, CC, the police chief, and the fire chief.
Yeah, we're okay.
Okay.
You're going to give notice, but he's not going to have to approve.
Yeah.
Correct. So we're going to
Yeah.
I think Mr. Kamalo just wants to go to all these events and inspect them and hang out.
I'll take that.
Okay.
Just one last, the last comment. Since we mentioned saving food, do you mind describing to the board how that would work?
Yeah, I mean, yes. Is better, but my understanding is that if we're going to have food, it's a catered event. There's a caterer coming in, serving the food, taking it all away.
Okay.
Yes, that's exactly. Nothing to be prepared or cooked there.
Okay. Okay. I'm all set.
All set. Okay. So we didn't really sort of straw poll on the 250. I'm okay with 250. This is a one-year deal. If 250 is too much, we're going to find out very quickly, and we're going to deal with it in year two, or if it gets out of control in any one event, we can deal with it sooner than that. So I'm okay with the 250. I think there was general okay with 250. There's some reluctance for good reason, but I think that's the general consensus. So I think you have everything you need to work out the final details with the HCA. Is that a fair statement?
That's what I realized. In the spirit of moving the discussions forward, and given the concessions that the town has made, we will work from, there will be 30 events. Or is it 32?
I thought we said 32.
I thought we were okay.
32. 32. Okay.
We tabled that.
Yeah.
And
exactly.
The goal is to not have raging parties. The goal is to have a great HCA that is financially stable. And whether it's 30 or 32 events that make that happen, I don't have a strong opinion about that. If there's one raging party, we're going to all have a strong opinion about that. But these people are responsible and they get it. I think they've heard that loud and clear. So I would go with the 32, the 250, all alcohol. But then we got to sort those other things out that we agreed to. I think the town has been very accommodating here. And I hope we can get it resolved. So as promised, I was wrong. Mr. Sestari was right. We made some significant progress tonight. I will get a text from him soon. I can assure you of that. So I think you have some marching orders now to try and sort it out. We're not done yet, okay? Just so you know. But thank you. Okay, so we're good there. So I think the chair, should entertain a motion to direct the town manager and town council to get with the HCA and work out the final details of a license agreement amendment to be presented.
Addendum
to be presented to the Board of Selectmen at its next regularly scheduled meeting for authorization for signature.
With all those.
With all, they got to work it all out. Yeah. So we have a motion on the table and a second to get it done. All those in favor? Aye. Any opposed? Okay. Next up, there's a one-day liquor license request. Okay. In front of us this evening from the... Okay, so who's requesting this, the HCA or the Chamber of Commerce? It's kind of... Okay, so the HCA is asking, with in coordination with the Chamber of Commerce, the Hopkinton Chamber of Commerce, to be granted a one-day liquor license for an event to be held on October 18th, 2016. We've got, I think, everything we would typically need for a one-day liquor license. Any questions? Chair will entertain a motion to approve the one-day liquor license for the Chamber of Commerce event to be held at the HCA on October
18,
2016.
Second.
Okay, we have a motion and a second. Mrs. Wright.
Sure. There were some comments from the Board of Health here that may not pertain to us, and I saw Mr. Wertman out in the hall. He's right there.
There he is. Hey, would you mind joining us for a minute at the
very welcoming table.
Warm colors on the wall.
Mrs. Wright.
I just would like Mr. Wharton to address his concerns. I'm not sure if they're within the purview of this board or not, but they were certainly raised among the permitting team comments, so it should certainly be heard.
Well, since those comments went out, we had further discussion. I spoke with Kelly today. We have no objection to the one-day liquor license.
Okay.
Mrs. Wright.
As long as it's been addressed.
All set?
Okay, so we have a motion on the table and a second. Any further discussion? Mr. Sestari.
Yeah, I was just wondering how big this is going to be. You know, just in terms of what we had just been discussing for the last hour, you know, I see that this is going to be a weeknight. And it's supposed to end at 10 when we just agreed with 9:30. And then the other thing is, you know, we don't know what the size is. And I see that Lieutenant Porter did raise a slight concern that it's a school night. And I'm just wondering if this is expected to be over 100 people, and if it is going to be over 100 people, if we expect that there's going to be a police detail.
Yeah. We actually, the hours have been updated. That was the maximum. I think it's going to actually end about 7:30. It's really a networking event where people are coming and going, and it's not going to be, we hope there's a lot of people, but it is very soon, and we haven't had much time to advertise it. Probably not very good.
Okay. Thank you.
Mr. Richardson, do you concur?
It's a business and craft expo. There's tables going to be set up for people that either chamber members or outside members that want to rent them and talk about what services and crafts they're offering, as well as kind of the networking event. So I hope we get 50, 60 people. I mean, we'll get more, but I think that's all.
Okay, great. Anybody else? All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Any opposed? Okay, well, all set there. Next up on the agenda, item number 11 is the budget policy statement on behalf of the Board of Selectmen. And we're in the process of trying to accelerate the budget process in general in town. We've got the charter review process coming up, obviously, in a special town meeting to look at things, and the charter review committee is kicking around the budget schedule that's currently outlined in the charter, et cetera, et cetera. Mr. Kamalo, given where we are this evening and sort of our desire to be sure our colleagues from the school committee and elsewhere are sort of in full alignment with us, what are your thoughts about this agenda item tonight?
I respectfully suggest the board postpone discussing this topic to its next meeting in 2 weeks.
Will that impact our attempt to accelerate the budget process for 2016? Sorry, 17, FY17? No, 18, right? We're working on FY18.
Yes, FY18. We were shooting for an accelerated schedule. Speaking with the CFO, Chris Sandini, we believe we will still be able to meet our target deadlines.
Okay.
We will instruct town departments to start working on the budget.
Okay. And if you had an opportunity to reach out to our colleagues at the school department, including Dr. McLeod, specific to the sort of preliminary budget and so forth that we want to get going on?
Yeah, we had preliminary discussions in terms of how we could approach the budget message. Based on the feedback that you and I received from the chair of the school committee, I think it's appropriate that I settle back with there and see how we move this forward.
Yeah, we want to make sure we can at least get some kind of representation from the school committee with us on the 18th of October, right?
Yes.
Okay, great. Everybody good with that? Okay. Item number 12. So no need for us to take any action on item number 11. Item number 12, FY17 goal setting. Maria's here with us this evening. She's been very patient back there. I apologize, we were running behind. But to Mr. Sestari's credit, we got a lot done. Maria, if you would join us up here, and Chief Lee, you can probably come on up as well. We're talking about
us moving down the path of setting goals for the police chief and the town manager for FY 17. At our last meeting, or a couple of two meetings ago now, I believe it was, we went through each of us individually, and the process has changed this year because of some Mass General Law input and so forth. But we went through and pretty much fired off what all of us would like to see from the various individuals that you have before you now. And, you know, you've got the police chief, fire chief, town manager, and each one of us sort of, and she, Maria captured kind of what our thoughts were in terms of goals for these folks. It hasn't sort of been codified yet, but we want to make sure that we're on the right path with each of these. And then we'll sort of take it to the next step. I think the next step is really trying to get each of our direct reports 3 to maybe 5 specific goals we'd like them to focus on for FY17. It's October. You know, this is sort of like how we do it at work. I mean, it's usually 6 months into the year before you get all this stuff. But we all do our jobs every day anyway. So what I'd like to try and do, at least for the police chief and the town manager tonight, because the fire chief's not here, is try and get the 3 and 5 goals. Right? Is that how you would like to see us proceed as our HR director?
I don't think we'll ever get through that. We should work
on okay, the sarcasm's noted. And you're right. We're out of here. Sarcasm's noted. And we're going to keep going anyway. Maria, but are you okay? I mean, am I describing it the way you see it playing out based on everything we've had to absorb with Mass General Law this year?
Yes. And the only, you know, general recommendation, if you will, is depending on the depth of the goals, how much meat is to them, mm-hmm. 3 is generally a good number. Mm-hmm. You know, some of these, you know, the corridor advancement or, you know, the fire chief's, you know, recommendation of a community engagement outreach program, they have a lot of components mm-hmm. to them, so.
Okay. So if everybody would take a minute and look at the police chief goals that we all rattled off a couple weeks back, do one or two of these really jump out at individuals that we need to make sure we focus in on? I mean, I would say the accreditation, because that had been on there prior. And we achieved the first phase, and we're working on the second phase. So I think the accreditation for the department was across several of us, right? So I think that's, and I'm not putting them in order of priority here. I'm just kind of throwing them out.
I think the teenage concerns and opioid awareness, alcohol, substance abuse, all of that kind of stuff bundled into one.
So teenage concerns, opioid, alcohol.
The staffing model.
Staffing for the future.
To keep, you know, let's look at it so we're not surprised at any one point. We know what we need going.
So planning for the future growth. Mm-hmm. Staff planning. Okay, so we have 3, at least right now. I'm sorry?
Chairman, both directions. If there's ways of the chief to see that things might be able to be streamlined, you know, you could show... know how you could take 2 positions, make them into 1, and then
sure.
Get creative and do something else also.
So a staffing plan, the accreditation second phase, and the teenage concerns, and focus on community opioid awareness, alcohol abuse, etc. Any others for the police chief that really jump out at you?
Chairman, when I spoke with the chief, he had mentioned securing the software system for enhancement of accreditation training. That seems to be a component of that accreditation goal.
Correct.
Anyway, so maybe that doesn't need to be a separate goal. That can just be included in that action item.
Would you agree, Chief, that that's part of your accreditation phase 2 process?
Absolutely.
Yes, we would put that in there.
Yeah.
Okay.
I think the accreditation is something that we're all confident that the chief's going to continue to work on. But it seems to me that the last couple of years when we've talked to him about it, and I'm not saying this is any kind of a fault or anything like that, but it's difficult to determine exactly what the goal is for where we're going to get with accreditation each year. And without that ability to measure that, all it is really saying, yeah, chief, continue to work on accreditation. And I don't know if that's something that I really want to judge you on in June, you know, in terms of, you know, how well you did.
One thing that's not that we can really reach is obtain certification, which is the first process for accreditation. Mm-hmm. And we're pretty close to that now, like putting all our policies.
Well, of course you want it as a goal, since you're pretty close to it. Well,
but it might not happen. But it might not happen quite a lot, I would say. And the other thing I'd just like to add as far as exploring the tasers or non-lethal, since we were out last year, we were getting a lot of buzz of police department, and something that, you know, maybe long overdue, and it was something that I planned on bringing forward to the board with a presentation with my staff and explaining the need for.
There's an awful lot in the news these days about that topic, and you know, some of the things that have gone on in the country, unfortunately. But I think it's something that is of interest to the people of Hopkinton. I know Mr. Tedstone brought it forward. So, from my perspective, staff planning sort of happens as part of the budget process. The staff planning involves our colleagues in the police patrolman's union. So I think maybe would probably be better to leave that one for those discussions and have the non-lethal force and even the study of body cameras. I mean, I'm interested in sort of this whole body camera discussion. I mean, we've got them in the front of the car. Why not have them in front of the body? I don't know the pros and cons, but I'd be interested in understanding a little bit more about that. So maybe having that as a goal to kind of sort through and make some recommendations would be something to do. So if we went with the teenage crisis, alcohol, opioid, you know, that whole topic as one goal that we want to get our head around more, the accreditation, getting into the second phase and getting that accomplished to include software and so forth, and then maybe a study of the new tools and technologies available to police for police work to include tasers and, you know, the use of body cams, the pros and cons, something along those lines. Would those be three good goals?
I think that those are good. I would like to keep the staffing model in, though, because I know personally I'm not as interested in you know, next year. You know, I'm sure the chief has a real good idea of, you know, the way things are trending right now and what he needs for the budget. I'm more interested in the future growth 5 years, 10 years out, and, you know, I guess giving some thought into what the triggers are for, you know, needing an organizational, you know, change in the model, or, you know, X number of new officers or something like that. Similar to the request that we were discussing with the fire chief in terms of, okay, at what point do we need another fire station? And, you know, are there any thoughts about where the ideal location would be for something like that, and staffing models along those lines? So I personally would still like to see something in there for more the strategic, the strategic study, I guess.
Okay. Mrs. Wright, anything else?
Well, I was just saying, jumping onto what Mr. Sestaris just said, in light of the current and projected growth, it would be better to have some projections as to when these needs are going to kick in, rather than waiting until we're behind the eight ball and then trying to scramble to catch up. We should be, you know, synthesizing the community growth with the staffing needs going forward.
Okay. Anybody down here? Okay. So, Maria, can you work on pulling those three or four together? And then we'll clean that up and have that be one set of goals for the chief going forward, but I think we're almost there, okay? Our goal tonight was just to try and bring it a little tighter in, and then go from there. We'll nail them down and vote it and put it in writing very soon, next meeting, okay? Town manager, go to, everybody good to go to the town manager? Chief, you good with what we're talking about?
Yes.
Good, okay. All right, so town manager. Kind of like what we just did with the police chief. Let's take a look here. I know it's kind of number one on mine, but I think it's on others as well, and it's been a goal that we've been working for a few years, and the town manager's office is driving it, is the downtown corridor project, and getting that out of 25% and above 50% or whatever is the next process, step in the process is to get ready for FY18, I think. So that would be one that I would encourage leaving out there, putting in there.
One of them that you know, this the number two one right there, and I actually get it down in mind, is branding. And we got an example of that with the report that Elaine gave us the other day with the report on businesses.
Business guide.
The guide.
You know, and that's, you know, to me, it's, that's the whole thing is branding for our town.
Okay. Any others?
I think that the finalization of the retention plan, that seems to be mentioned a couple of times, and you know, having that focusing on employee morale, and I think it really will incorporate a few of the items that are in here. More than likely, promotion from within and empowering employees to grow, morale, you know, all of that kind of ties together.
Okay. See you, Brennan. So strategic plan. Street corridor. I think those are three good ones. The strategic plan, downtown corridor, advancement, you know, getting that thing moving, keeping along. Visibility, Maria would object. Visibility in the community and increasing the brand. So branding for the town manager's office along with the community itself. And then a review of the structure in place, any anticipated changes, and a retention plan, sort of as an employee management plan, something along those lines. Mr. Kamala, what are your thoughts on those three or four? Try to blend them together and make them three.
I think the first three dovetail with the goals that the board has set for the police chief as well. And so I'm fine with the first three. I'm eager to get started on the strategic plan for the town. We may not include this as an official goal, but this is a project that I really want to embark on, build upon the vision process that the town completed a year ago.
I think he could have a stretch goal or, you know, a strategic plan, throw that in the mix.
I like that one.
So there's three or four there, Maria, that we can just clean up a little bit more, I think, and take this list down to those numbers, and then we can sit and kind of clean that up, you and I. You know what, I want to go back to the police chief, though. I know he left, because his contract, now that he's gone, his contract had some specific goals as part of his contract that's in place, correct?
And he's got categories for consideration of evaluating them.
And did we touch on those as we went through his goals tonight, just a few minutes ago here? Did what's in his contract get covered by what we discussed, or is that in addition? Or is that a separate sort of criteria?
I can put it out quickly for the board.
There might be
got some criteria. It's kind of like, I think, maybe more performance-based than goals.
Yeah, so command, personnel management, structure. I think there's seven of them.
Yeah.
I don't have it right now.
As part of us pulling together his three that we talked to him about tonight, let's see how they fit with what's in that contract to make sure that we're covering, you know, what we need to cover from the contractual obligations point of view. Do you remember what I'm talking about?
I really don't.
Okay.
I trust you.
Yeah, because
your memory's better than mine on that, but I don't remember.
No, Maria reminded me a while back about it. So, okay, we'll work into that too. Just make that note as part of his codification, if you will, but as we codify on it, it's a word. Okay. So with that, I think we can move on from goal setting. Everybody good?
Good.
Liaison assignments and board invites. Have we seen any invites as of late, Elaine, that you're aware of?
No.
Yes, there was.
What's that?
There's
oh, the graveyard tour.
I saw the sandwich board. I assume that's an invite.
You didn't look. It's got a
it's right here. Yeah, it's
really
not, it's
spooky.
It's in color.
You better come. You might even learn something if you dare. Look at that. How did you miss that? You didn't look.
Nope.
Ooh, sorry. I got a personal.
It's at the bottom of the scroll.
Don't miss it.
Okay. Mr. Kamal, I got with Maria, and we're going to double check his contract against what we've been talking about, and if we're missing a couple, we'll talk to him about them and get those worked in as well. Okay. So invites, Mr. Kamal, any invites of consequence come up that you're aware of? Maria, we're all set. Thank you. Have a good night.
Thank you, Maria. I think the one that comes to mind is the event that the chamber has given us an advance warning. They are working on a specific date, namely the state of the town address. They are hoping to schedule that towards, I think, the end of October. I don't have a specific date yet.
Okay. All right. Anything else?
No.
Okay, liaison assignments. Mr. Catino, anything?
No, Brendan and I went to the last weekend.
Excellent.
As far as liaison assignments, nothing else to report.
Mrs. Wright.
Not tonight.
Mr. Sestari.
Charter Review Committee's met a couple of times. I tell you, it's a group of go-getters there. Lots of meetings, very productive meetings. But probably the most important one was it was 2 weeks ago. We had the public forum that was held at HCAM. It was televised, and there were also people in the audience. Total in the audience, I think there were maybe 11 people. They had a lot of opinions across those 11, and so we got lots of input. We've been mulling over that. We've had another meeting since. We've gotten through a lot of that. We're in the process of really just kind of bringing that all together, though, and in the next meeting or two, I believe we're going to start going through the individual items and starting to give our own opinions and take some votes on whether or not the committee is going to support some of the changes. The only other thing was the chair did ask me to, notify or remind the board that while an official request has not been made at this point, it's likely that we'll be looking for a special town meeting. I believe it was February 13th. Is that correct, Mr. Kamalo? Does that ring a bell? It's immediately, it's the week before the February break starts in the schools. And that's kind of a timing that will work well in terms of getting approval through the Attorney General, and then bringing anything to annual town meeting or ballot if we have to.
Okay. Thank you. Mr. Catino.
Yeah, I did have one more that I forgot to bring up. The Irvine Todaro Committee would like to come make an interim presentation to us to show us where we stand and in the next couple meetings.
Okay, we can work that into the agenda.
Speaking of land acquisitions, the Pratt Farm Committee that I'm on, we just got some information from DPW and their engineering consultant specific to watershed areas on that land, and that's going to help us figure out where we would site certain things, including a future well, as well as the Boy Scout camp, which is one of the main reasons that we acquired the land. And it looks like we're going to have a meeting hopefully next week at some point to kind of review that and sort of restart the engine of siting the scout camp, because we kind of stalled until we figured out where the water was underneath or under land there. But I do want to go back to something specific. It's not a future agenda item yet, but we had our consent agenda this evening and we voted the consent agenda. We just broke out item number 3, and we voted the consent agenda under item 4, number 4. It says Board of Selectmen Liaison to Hopkinton Schools Athletic Field Subcommittee. It doesn't say who is the Board of Selectmen Liaison to the Hopkinton Schools Athletic Field Subcommittee. The schools are looking at doing some kind of field renovation work or turf field or whatever. They're trying to figure it all out. And I was at the school committee meeting when that came up. I've been at the field walkthroughs with the schools and the coaching staff because my son plays, and I just got sucked into it. But they said the other night, well, we want you to be on the committee. I said, I can't be on anything until my board votes to appoint somebody as the liaison. It would not be a voting member of that committee because you can't be on different things and so forth that might come before us. But they are looking for a representative of our committee, our board, to serve as a liaison to check in and monitor and offer input on the athletic schools field subcommittee. Does anybody have an interest in serving in that role?
So are you saying questions about the committee? I'm sorry.
Well, are you willing to do it?
I'm happy to do it, but if somebody else wants to do it, I'm happy to let them do it too. So it's either or to me.
This is my question, as you said that it's not a voting member. So how's the committee made up? And
so this is a
voting member.
It's school committee controlled land. Mm-hmm. So the school committee put together a list of, I believe it was 9 individuals, 2 school committee members, Kathy McLeod, you know, business manager, somebody from 2 people from the general public, somebody from various organizations. So the school committee constituted, like we constitute a new committee. They did that, and as part of that, they said they'd like to have a board of selectmen liaison to that committee, and I think a parks and rec liaison to that committee or some other entity. But we wouldn't be a voting member, so they're the ones that set it up that way. So we should name somebody to be the liaison to that committee. Did I describe it right as to how they put it together?
Yes.
I just want to make sure that if we're doing something like this, that Parks and Rec is really, if we suggest it, if it could be suggested by our liaison, because they have been running the Fruit Street fields for a few years and have gone through a bunch of, been put through the trials already of how to keep up fields and how to keep them going and how to manage them in order to get the most efficiency out of them. And so just let's make sure that that we're not reinventing the wheel by to coming up with a whole separate committee. Let's use the intelligence that we've already gathered and not have to all over again.
I can tell you that I raised the question about, you know, how the Parks and Rec would play in that role, because I was attending that meeting that night, not representing us, but just sitting there as myself, and I made that clear. And while they heard what I said about Parks and Rec, they went ahead and constituted the committee. So the school committee wanted to pull that together, and they didn't do it sort of flippantly, or they just didn't ignore me. They understood and recognized and so on. But they were already down a path. So point well made, and I think they understand and they recognize that, but they are moving down a path already.
And they don't have a rep from Parks and Rec on the committee?
Not as a voting member, no.
How about as a?
I think as a liaison, they will. Yeah, they'll have like us, like we would be.
I mean, they certainly should be, as John says, using that institutional knowledge, and it's just not good town business to have two similar entities working at cross purposes.
Trying to remember on the committees that we had for Pratt Farm and for the Irvine Todaro property, how were those constituted?
Irvine Todaro had school committee members, us.
One of each.
Pratt did not. Pratt was just mostly us, scouts, Parks and Rec, open space. It wasn't so much, it wasn't school coordinated as much.
I just want to make sure that all that knowledge doesn't go to waste.
I agree. I think it's more, well, the point is moot anyway. They've already started down that path, but I think it is important for Parks and Rec to bring their experience and knowledge to the table. They've done a great job managing the fields, maintaining the fields. The fields that they maintain in town are heads and shoulders above any others, in my opinion. And I think it's a shame to waste that knowledge.
Okay. So with that, are you guys okay if I go to that committee as liaison, or do you want somebody else want to do it?
Nominate Brian Herr.
Okay, so this is inside. How do we do this, Mr. Kamal? This is inside the consent agenda. This isn't a contested issue here.
Right,
so
it's not a contested issue. We can vote. The board can vote to reopen the consent agenda.
Okay, so the chair will entertain a motion to reopen a consent agenda item on the agenda.
Breakout 4-4.
All right, Scribner's error that I'm the liaison that was voted previously. Good.
Don't be a wallflower.
Mr. Kamal, do you have anything to report in the next 30 seconds?
Yeah, quickly, under the town manager's report, I am requesting the selectmen approve the use of $42,088 of insurance proceeds towards the installation of the Hopkins boiler replacement update. This vote is required under the new law that Governor Becker approved as part of the Municipal Modernization Act of 2016. You may recall this issue was before town meeting. Town meeting approved only $46,000 for the boiler. The bids for a high efficiency boiler came in at approximately $166,000. Leaving a shortfall of approximately $120,000. And so if the board is inclined to approve the use of the insurance proceeds, that will add to the $46,000 approved at town meeting, leaving a shortfall of approximately $78,206. The school committee did vote to apply part of its operating budget funds to offset this cost. They can, in the future, rely on revolving funds to replenish the school committee operating budget. Though,
sorry,
to be
what was
clear,
that last part? They can rely on what?
Revolving accounts. Yes, they have revolving accounts that they can use. But the matter before the board is authorizing the use of the insurance proceeds towards the Hopkins boiler installation.
So it's no additional cost to the taxpayers.
No. How did we get from town meeting voting to approve $46,000 to getting a price on a high efficiency boiler of 100 and whatever?
Did the estimate?
I don't know.
So the estimate was a couple years old. This is the same meeting I was at.
Even at that.
The estimate was a couple years old. And when the estimate was done, we were in the throes of the Great Recession. And then obviously things have heated up and costs have increased and labor is down.
Are we purchasing the same thing that the original estimate was for and that town meeting voted on?
Town meeting voted for a boiler. The estimate came in for a standard efficiency boiler. The bid that I'm referencing is for a high efficiency boiler.
What's the what's the ROI on the high efficiency for the $80,000 difference or $120,000 difference.
Yeah, I recall specifically they referenced 4 years payback.
4 years payback?
Yeah, hold on a second.
But it's the quote for the standard boiler now is $147,900, yeah. And the quote for the high efficiency
is $166,000.
So it's only it's a $19,000 difference.
They were 100. We voted 46 at town meeting. It came in at 149, and now the high efficiency one is
167.
Yeah. So having been at the school committee meeting when all this went on, they are as frustrated and concerned and whatever we are about the process as we are now articulating. They've been through all this, and they talked about all this, and they talked to their team about it, and it's not like they just, someone said, hey, we need 100 grand. I said, okay. So they've been through this whole deliberative process to try and minimize
this. We can get beat up for at town meeting when people say, they were giving you 46, but then you guys spend $100,000 more.
Go ahead.
I'm just wondering where 46 came from. I mean, prices couldn't have gone up that much. They must have gotten some bad numbers at the beginning. Goes back to the original quote.
Yeah, the I think the 46 was not a high efficiency boiler.
Not to beat this thing because it's after 10:30, but
yeah, we got to give them credit. They know what they're. Yeah. They're working on it.
Yeah, but 2 years ago we were not deep in a recession.
No, when they got the quote, it was a couple of years before that.
So the quote was 4 years old?
It's a couple years old.
I think it may have come from.
I don't know. I didn't do it. This is not. We didn't do this. Our job is to approve the insurance piece.
My only other question is the insurance piece. What was the insurance from? What was it a result of?
Trying to remember, we filed an insurance claim because the boiler failed.
Was related to the boiler.
Yes.
Yes.
And the failure.
Yeah, clearly,
of the
it's for this. It's for the boiler.
All right.
Yeah. To Mr. Cortino's comment, going forward, we will have a much more thorough CIC process now that we. We have staffing in the finance office. The CFO has been charged with coming up with guidelines that will ensure that the information that gets to CIC, that gets to the selectmen, is vetted well in advance, and that we will include much more current bids in estimating the cost of any project.
Mr. Chair, I move that we approve the use of the insurance proceeds from the boiler claim toward the purchase of the new high-efficiency boiler.
Motion by Mr. Sestari and a second by Mrs. Wright. Any further discussion? Are you good with the motion, Mr. Kamalo?
Yes.
All those in favor?
Aye. Aye.
Any opposed? Mr. Kamalo, anything else on the town manager's report?
No.
Future agenda items. Board members. Mr. Catino.
Same one I brought up last meeting. Let's look at reappropriating the center school.
So we have to begin a formal process to dispense with that asset as part of the school building, elementary school building, new school building process. The MSBA requires that you go through a whole series of discovery items. Don't they?
The MSBA required the town to articulate a process for disposing of the surplus property.
Right.
We did several months ago.
Yeah.
And part of that process included the selectmen identifying in consultation with the school committee how that process will move forward.
So we need to probably have a joint meeting with them at some point between now and the end of the year to start figuring out how that's going to look. So to your point, for a future board agenda. But that just has to be a joint meeting.
Yeah, so
this
now is the process the way it ends up rolling out after the new school opens, then the school committee turns that property back over to the town, and then the town determines what to do with it. So I guess, first of all, I'm not saying that I don't want to hear other boards and committees' opinions, but I think that the first step is probably just getting a formal vote from the school committee or opinion from the school committee that that is their intent, that once the new school opens, that they intend to turn that property back over to the town. And so that way we can officially say, yep, you know, we hear it, and now we can start planning for it. And after that, I think in terms of getting input from other boards and committees, the school committee's opinion is just as important as the planning board's opinion and, you know, DPW's and other groups. But in the end, it's this board's decision. Okay. And the town's at town meeting.
All right.
Okay.
Any other future board agendas?
All set?
Chair, I'll entertain a motion to adjourn.
So moved.
Second?
Second.
Thank you.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Good night.